discussion to the motion? All those in favor? Okay, it's unanimous. And next up, disclosures of pecuniary interest. Do we have any disclosures for tonight? Counselor Morocco?
Yes, sir. I have a check number, 355546. This is $55.
Okay, thank you. Counselor Iannone?
I have check number 359525, and it was received to my spouse.
Okay, thank you. Any other disclosures? Counselor, no? Okay. That's it for the disclosures. We're now going to move to the budget portion of tonight's meeting. I'd ask our budget chair, Counselor Peter Angelo, to come forward.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. On the agenda tonight, there's two parts of the budget. There's going to be some presentations by different departments, and there's also a report that deals with the Niagara Falls Community Outreach. I know that there are representatives from the Community Outreach Program here tonight, and perhaps it would be appropriate to move the report forward now so that they wouldn't have to sit through the presentations, moved by Councillor Iannone, seconded by Councillor Wing. So we'll bring that report forward, and I'm not sure if... A motion for approval, okay. Motion to move the recommendation by Councillor Iannone, seconded by Councillor Thompson. Is there any questions or comments at all to this? Yes, Councillor Thompson?
Yeah, when I read this, it was very disturbing that we even have to go through this process. You know, it's not a huge expenditure for the municipality, and the work that is done there for so many years, and the volunteerism that probably second to none that goes on every day throughout our community, and to think that the impact would determine that this wasn't something that would be exempt from taxation is beyond my belief. I support the resolution at this point, but I would suggest that we follow through with a resolution. Of course, there isn't a government there now, but to impact, indicating that this is something that has to be an oversight, that there is no way that there should be any tax on this volunteer, extremely necessary effort that goes on in our community, especially in the economic climate that we're in today. And I think that we should do not only to the government, but the impact through our provincial member of parliament, and make it very clear that this is insignificant as far as the municipality is concerned with the dollars, but it should not even should have been not even before us, because in my opinion it should be exempt regardless.
Okay, and I would imagine that that would be a friendly amendment to the mover of the motion.
Yeah.
Okay. Was there any other question or comment to the report? If not, then the motion on the floor is to approve the recommendation and also to send a resolution on to MPAC asking them for a full relief of any taxes in the future. I'll call the vote. All those in favor? Opposed? Motion's carried unanimously. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Merry Christmas. We'll move on to the presentation portion of the budget. And I believe we have the Municipal Works Department going first, and I would ask Mr. Holman if he would like to start his presentation.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. Municipal Works operating budget is one of the largest cost centers that we have in the municipality. This year's budget represents about a $17.6 million expenditure. And I think it's a reasonable 0.72% increase over last year. This year the focus isn't so much on expansion, it's more on optimization and customer service, and you'll see that in the numbers. The Municipal Works Department, the budget funds have five. It covers the number of pages, and depending on how you'd like to go through them, I'll give you just a brief overview, and then you can answer some questions. I've got John Morocco and Cynthia Roberts here to help me answer any questions you might have. Basically, Municipal Works is organized into two major departments, engineering and operations. The engineering group operates out of the city hall here, represents about 18% of the staff. And operations works out of both the service center and Fairview Cemetery. If you break up the staff by function, you'll see that most of the staff works in either roadways, parks, or cemeteries. There is a contingent of staff there under environmental services, and a portion of the administration staff that are allocated to the utility budget. And that budget will be before you early in 2013. The activities are broken down into 12 major categories, and then broken down into various programs underneath them. So I won't spend too much time describing them because you'll see them broken down as we go through. But before we get into the numbers, it's probably helpful to look at some of the statistics to give us a little bit of context as to what we're dealing with here. The numbers are there for you to understand kind of the scope and scale of the work. One of the stats I think is important is the growing number of requests. You'll see that we're documenting and recording in our maintenance management system, the cartograph requests. It's increasing on a regular basis, and we expect that we'll be able to get some even more useful information out of the data that we're collecting in response to requests from the public over the next year or so. Okay, as far as the proposed budget, in the roadway services, we're seeing an increase in the amount of asphalt patching and paving that we have to do in our road system. So we're looking at an increase in contracted services. And part of that is some of the uncertainty associated with the price of asphalt. With respect to unpaved surfaces, last year we experienced a really hot, dry summer and faced some additional costs associated with dust control. And so we bumped that budget up a little bit. With respect to sidewalk maintenance, because of the rules for determining what is a capital and what is an operating expense, we are reducing the amount of work that we're doing in-house. And so our materials budget on the sidewalk maintenance is slightly down. Our drainage ditch and culvert maintenance program is increased largely as a result of the recalculation of our internal equipment rental rates. Our forestry group is basically status quo, and there are some minor reductions in contracted services under roadside maintenance this year, as well as some minor reductions and adjustments to administrative costs under the other roadside services. We spoke a little bit last meeting about our winter maintenance program, and because of the milder weather, we've had ample supply of sand and salt, so we're reducing our materials budget slightly. And then on the sidewalk maintenance, we are anticipating that we will have some damage as a result of sidewalk plowing activities. The lack of frost in the ground exposes us a little bit more risk that way. Our streetlight maintenance contract will be renewed again this year. We're anticipating a slight increase. And one of the larger increases in the budget this year is the impact of our electricity costs, our power charges to our streetlight system. And we hope to have a solution to control that expense in the next couple of months when we bring the results of our LED pilot study to you.
Under engineering services, this is the group that delivers our capital works program. There are some higher insurance costs allocated to this, this function, resulting in a 5.2% increase. Development services, we're adding some additional money into the contracted services account to give us some ability to peer review some of our local service policies for development charges bylaw when it comes before you later on this year. Our infrastructure services program is increased. We're increasing we're putting in an allowance for an opportunity to look at optimizing our operations out of the service center. We recognize we have a facilities located in the north end of the city, and as we grow to the south and west, we need to look at reducing some of our travel times and make ourselves more efficient. And we're also looking at the condition of the existing facility to see whether or not it makes sense to invest a lot of more money into protecting and restoring that building. There's also a provision in there for our biannual culvert and bridge inspection program. Under project and construction services, essentially status quo. And under fleet and equipment services, we have some slight increases as a result of insurance and materials costs. Our storm sewer system, we are basically status quo. There was some debt, the ventures that have been paid off, so there's some reduction there. Recycling services are those in-house services that are allocated to this function. It's basically a small amount of money. And the pest control services are being increased slightly in terms of dollars, $1,500, to reflect some of the year-to-date actual costs. Under railway maintenance, there's an increase in contracted services because we want to undertake some additional repairs to the Morrison Street railway crossing. Moving on to cemeteries, grounds maintenance is increasing because we're going to be resolving an outstanding issue with the lead hand position that is currently vacant. Cemetery facilities, we're increasing the budget for materials. Slight decline in the cost associated with burial services as a result of our projections for fewer burial services. Fewer burials. And under cemetery development, we have moved a lot of that money into the capital budget as opposed to trying to do that in-house.
On that point? Absolutely.
Thank you. Last week I asked a question in regards to cemetery burial costs, and it was in regards to providing the tents to families who are burying their loved ones, and I asked for a cost projection. How much revenue have we actually raised since that became an issue? I heard from many residents the day after that who said, you know what, we don't think it's fair that we have to pay that. It's onerous to us. Can you explain it with what I have in front of me from page 122 of the budget? Because they're all in a deficit. So are we not making money out of that? I'm a little confused. In your revenue.
I'm sorry, the page reference again, Council?
It says it's 122. And then cemetery burial services, 122 to 124. So I'm wondering if we're not making any money doing that anyway, why are we charging people?
Well,
because our guys are there, the tents are there. I don't understand.
Okay, well, I mean, that was a decision the council made.
I understand that.
We have to look at the larger picture, and I think you'll get a better feeling for it when we present the service delivery review. You know, for a municipality that basically has a captive customer base, we're losing money every year, significant amount of money. And it's because we're not charging enough, quite frankly, for the services that we provide. Now, we always have this discussion with the funeral directors, and they recognize that that they can't pass a lot of these costs onto their clients. However, we have to ask ourselves whether or not it's reasonable that the rest of the residents of the community are prepared, or should they be prepared to offset these costs? Or is this a service that should be operated more on a user pay? There are changes in trends, there's changes to how people are looking at, you know, a lot of people aren't burying, using full burial services anymore, a lot of cremation. And quite honestly, we have to make sure that we don't price ourselves out of the picture. But at the same time, if this is a service that is really an extra, then it's something that that we should be charging. There is a report that's drafted. It's on my desk, and we haven't had a chance to really vet it through senior staff. But I would expect that we'd have it here for the 8th of January, if you could be patient for that. Thank you. Okay, cemeteries administrative services then is status quo. Moving to parks, small increase in parks related to contracted services for things like security and electricity increases. Our athletic fields, pretty much the same. There is some reduction in the other park services account, largely due to staffing changes. And then our landscape design group is essentially status quo. Okay, so the expenditures, this budget is really just a straightforward, similar to last year, with the only difference being more of an aggressive internal look at what we do and how we do it. We're going to be looking at our capital project delivery process. We have some weaknesses in how we're getting our capital projects out the door, the timing of that, and going to be straightening that up a little bit. We'll be presenting a service delivery review for all of our cemetery services that will likely be in February sometime. We're going to be working on an aggressive asset management plan and implementing some of the policies there. One of the problems that we have is our capital program is based on kind of the worst first approach, and because of our infrastructure deficit. However, there are situations where we should be investing money in certain assets to make sure we get the full life from them, and that will avoid some of these, reduce the number of very expensive projects that we have on our capital forecast list. We're going to be looking at operational reviews, particularly roadside mowing and some of these activities where there's less value, and realigning and reassigning our staff to those projects that require more customer-centric service. Consulting services engagement policy we'll be dealing with early in January. Talk a little bit about development charges background study and how we can accommodate growth and what the impact of growth is on not only the infrastructure but also our operations. Kathy Moldenauer will be presenting a recreation master plan and some of the impacts it's going to have on our operating budget moving forward early in the new year.
We'll be looking at a boulevard maintenance policy. Had some good discussions with our Parks and City Committee and got some good input as to what they would like to see, and we'll be meeting with them again. We'll be looking at a street tree and a urban forest management project to try and quantify the value of this asset that's important to the community, but hasn't really been documented and strengthened enough that we can develop some strong policies around. And then we'll be looking at our fleet, analyzing the costs associated with each piece of equipment, and coming up with solutions as to how to reduce our own operating costs. So those are the goals, some of the issues and funding challenges. We'll be dealing with succession planning and staff development, trying to train some younger staff and create positions for them to move up into the organization. We're looking at the growth, the impact of growth on our manpower and equipment resources. Over the last couple of years, we've added subdivisions to our asset inventory, but haven't substantially added manpower or equipment resources. So as a result, we're stretching out our levels of service, our response time, and we're getting close to the breaking point there. The public has been asking for higher levels of service. You've heard me talk a little bit about minimum maintenance standards and what it takes to satisfy our insurance company and risk management staff. Well, minimum maintenance standards are fine, but I think what we're feeling is that the public is asking for a level of service that goes beyond that in some areas. We're looking at risk management concerns, safety and security issues at the service center, and our current sidewalk policy that only really pertains to about one-third of the system. And we're also looking at the impact of underfunding our capital works program and the problems associated with having to maintain assets that have gone on beyond their useful life and the cost associated with that. And finally, what's not in the budget? Are a couple of positions. Equipment and safety coordinator position would be helpful for us to improve health and safety and performance of our staff. We would like to do a street tree inventory, one of those issues that whatever you don't measure, you don't manage, and we have a lot of issues, insurance claims associated with whose tree fell on my car, and how do we deal with those claims issues. It would be nice to have a program that is a little bit more proactive than the one we have. I talked a little bit about the Municipal Service Center and what the long-term plans are as we grow to the south and to the west. And we have had to take a provision for some renovations to the office and some of the improvements at the in the back of the operations, the service center. We were hoping that we could include provisions for a quality control clerk to help us start to document our service requests a little bit more efficiently. One of the problems we've had with the new minimum maintenance standards is that a lot of paperwork involved, and we're trying to encourage our supervisors to spend some more time out on the road to deal with issues before they start rather than in a more reactive way. And the last addition is that of a gardener that we would use in cemeteries and start to clean up a little bit some of the corners, some of the planters, and some of the areas that we think need a little bit more attention than what we're currently able to provide. Be happy to answer any questions or take any comments or any directives that can be.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Holman. Does any member of council have any questions of Mr. Holman? Okay, thank you. Moving on with the presentation then. Next, I believe we have the Planning, Building, and Development Department. And I believe that Mr. Herlovich is going to make the presentation.
Thank you, Councillor. The planning budget, which is what I'm going to deal with first, is found on pages 283 to 290 in your budget book. Planning Department has 14 full-time staff, one part-time staff. That's a student position that we hire each summer. The major activities of planning are review and processing, advising on applications for commercial, residential, and industrial development. We maintain and update the city's zoning bylaw official plan. We provide zoning regulations to the public, to businesses and municipal departments. We approve site plans for new commercial, industrial, and multiple family housing projects. We process applications for city council on subdivision approval and deal with minor variance and consent applications through committee of adjustments. Municipal Heritage Committee comes under the planning department, and we also administer the designated property grants through that committee. And then lastly, the planning department deals with community improvement plans and basically renewal of our urban infrastructure. The staffing accounts for 70% of our budget. We recover about 22.5% of our budget through application fees. The committee of adjustment is full cost recovery. The annual budget is about $1.3 million. That's planning, committee of adjustment, and heritage. There's a 2.8% year-over-year expenditure increase. That's largely due to increase of about $100,000 in grants that were, or grant money that we're seeking for the community improvement plan area. This is for the Gateway Economic Zone, which is along the QEW from Mountain Road to Netherby Road. This would be to provide tax increment financing for new businesses and industries that would locate along that corridor should that be approved. The department has one vehicle that's shared among the 14 staff members. The number of reviews that are being undertaken this year. We have a new comprehensive zoning bylaw that we hope to present to the public and council early in 2013. We're also dealing with a number of implementation strategies, dealing with the growth plan coming from the region and the province. We're currently updating our sign bylaw. We're reviewing second dwelling units. These are accessory apartments that the province is encouraging in single and two-family houses. We're currently reviewing cottage rental dwellings. These are the vacation houses that are rented in various residential areas throughout the city, and we're also reviewing the nightclubs. There are a number of key issues and challenges. That is, we always need additional funding for the, I mentioned the Gateway CIP already, and in addition the Drummondville CIP. And then we're challenged by the slow economic development due to global economics. And that's there any questions?
Okay, are there any questions of Mr. Herlovich?
Go back to the last slide.
Sure.
The key issues and funding challenges and pressures, right?
Yeah.
Can you just read out that last line again?
Slow development growth due to global economics.
Yeah. Okay, thank you.
You want me to read it exactly as it was written, or?
No. The point I've been trying to raise for a long time.
Okay.
What's the review of nightclubs?
This has to do with our regulations regarding the size of nightclubs in our various commercial districts.
and distance separations from one nightclub to another nightclub. That we've had problems in the past. It's an ongoing study. It's been on the books for a couple of years. No, I'm not.
Yeah, are there any questions of Mr. Hurlovich? If not, then I guess we'll proceed with the building division presentation.
Okay. Building division, the building department budget is found on pages 153 or 4 to 163 of your budget book. Building department has 20 full-time staff and one part-time staff. This is a summer help with the grounds and winter with snow removal around City Hall. The major activities, of course, of building are to ensure that all building construction meets the minimum standards of the Ontario Building Code, to ensure the minimum standards of property maintenance are met in accordance with our property standards bylaw, and we're responsible for the maintenance and minor renovations, capital improvements to city-owned buildings. The department brings in over $1 million in building permit fees annually. We work on a full cost recovery basis for building permits and inspections. To date, in 2012, we've had 471 new housing starts. That would include single, semis, and multiple family units. We've had 94 commercial building permits issued to date. And that's all its construction carries an estimated cost of construction, $135 million. The building property standards and facilities annual budget is $2.614 million. And that's a 0.67% increase over last year. The division has 8 vehicles which are assigned to various enforcement officers and inspection staff. The major reviews being undertaken. Review of building permit fees are going on now. We hope to bring those into with our next round of fee increases, which typically occur in the middle of the year, so that we could implement those for September 1st, 2013. We're also looking to refine our corporate policies and procedures in accordance with our Fresh Start business rules and directives that were recently adopted. There are a number of key issues that are facing the building division. That is the aging building stock, that is the municipal buildings, and I'm talking in terms of places like the Armory, Peterson's Workshop, the core building, City Hall itself. And these buildings require a major capital reinvestment, so that certainly will be a challenge in coming years. There are also changes to the Ontario Building Code with respect to energy. I think it was that last council meeting that we heard about the NEP and the audit that we're taking with respect to our buildings for energy efficiency. In terms of major areas of responsibility, again, it's the processing and issuance of building permits for sewers, drains, swimming pools, signs, and just about everything that needs a permit for construction would be handled by a building. We're also responsible for the inspection of those buildings, also sewers, signs, again, swimming pools, other matters coming under subdivision site plan agreements. We issue orders to comply and orders stop work orders under the Ontario Building Code when there are infractions. We respond to solicitors' letters regarding property transactions, lot grading and control of runoff from those lots comes under the building division with respect to new construction. We also conduct the inspections with respect to liquor licenses and business license applications. Respond and track the inquiries and complaints on property standards, review and provide comments to the Committee of Adjustment on and site plan agreements on various planning applications. We maintain and submit statistics to the Canada Mortgage and the Housing Corporation, and produce and manage the capital projects for city-owned buildings, as I've mentioned, and then calculate and collect the city and regional development charges that are due to the city. There are no additional staff requested within the building division. Those are the highlights.
Okay, again, are there any questions of Mr. Herlovich? Okay, if not, thank you for your presentation. I think next up we have the Business Development Department, and I believe that Mr. Felicetti is going to give the presentation.
Yes, thank you, Chair. Our budget information is found in your budget binder, pages 291 to 295. Our department complements in business development. We have four full-time staff, and we have one part-time staff, although that full complement is covered under our budget is shared with the CAO's office. And then we have two additional full-time staff in our Small Business Enterprise Center. And that center is actually in partnership with the Ministry of Economic Development. Our operation for business development, the budget between the BD and our Enterprise Center makes up about 0.06% of the total operating budget for the corporation. Some of the key activities that we deal with, we are the link between the municipality and the business community when it comes to a number of issues. Some of the programs, we conduct business visitation programs where we meet with these companies one-on-one, and we discuss issues that they're facing, whether it be within their corporate marketplace, whether it be issues with the municipality, anything that we can assist with. So we do this on a regular basis with these firms. We also, whenever we have companies that come to town or investors or site selectors or real estate groups, we're their first line quite often. We're the ambassador for the municipality. We often take them out on city tours. We share with them available property, whether it's greenfield, brownfield, or existing buildings. So that's a key component that we do. We also assist wherever we can, because this is a real key thing. When we do company visitations or you talk to developers, it's actually expediting proposals. That's key. So we deal a lot with each of the different departments when they go through this process. And often DD is at the start of a project and at the end of a project, and then we continue on with that company. You just don't end it there. We're again that link for the municipality to address any issues they might have from a municipal level. And so that's one of our key goals. And we also do a lot of research and data to help the business. If they're looking for any type of provincial or federal information, we'll get that for them when they're making their investment decisions. We also promote CIPs, whether it's brownfield or downtown, Main and Ferry. And that's if the budgets get approved, I guess. Main and Ferry, this one's always been asked for. Also, we facilitate some large-scale tourism events. Whether it be events like the New Year's Eve, Red Bull, and a number of others, we're often involved in that role, coordinating other departments, working with the industry. And to that point, when you see a lot of these events take place, a lot of it wouldn't happen if it wasn't for those tourism industries, particularly the BIA. They contribute hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars, to make those events happen. And you can't lose track of that. And those events, in many cases, bring a great deal of exposure to the community, to the city. It provides free events, actually, for the residents as well. So it's another positive. We also work closely with a new association that was formed, the Niagara Industrial Buyer-Seller Trade Show. We deal with the Industrial Association. And that was formed, actually, when we went to an event out about 4 years ago. We went to the oil sands. We took 27 companies. It was dealt through the Niagara Development Corridor Partnership, the five municipalities with economic development offices. And we went there and we took 27 companies. We realized, here we are thousands of miles away, we're on a trade show trying to get business, become part of a supply chain for the oil sands, and they didn't know each other. They're actually going to their own booths and saying, I didn't realize you made this. And so anyway, we started this trade show to really get them together, to network, and that association now has over 100 members. We host that show actually in Niagara Falls. Falls Casino is a major partner with that, and that turned out to be a very positive event for the manufacturers. In addition, we also have been very involved in large business infrastructure projects, such as GO Train. and we were very involved when we were dealing with the province in initiating the summer trade. And through the mayor's office and CAO and the chamber, we've been dealing quite a bit on trying to move that forward to full-time GO-Train service. And for the last year or so, we've been working with the Seaway Authority and GO-Train, senior levels of staff there, to see what it would take to make that proceed. And so that continues, but we're making some positive headway. Also, the WEGO system, we were very involved in dealing with that process. We're actually very involved with the federal and provincial governments in terms of the $50 million in capital. It's being administered in a sense to our office, but we serve as a co-chair with the federal government to oversee the project. And we did the same thing with the convention center, which was also received about $70 million from senior levels of government. We also work very closely with the mayor and the CAO's office in an advocacy role. A lot of things that we're dealing with requires the province, the different ministries, sometimes the premier's involvement, as well as federally. So we spend a lot of time actually in Queen's Park. We also promote, our budget isn't very large. We have a small advertising and marketing budget, but we primarily target it to the website. We do newsletters. We have a database of over 800 that we send it to. And we also do an annual report that we send to, again, site selectors, developers, the financial community, just to kind of share with them what's happening in the community, the type of development that's occurring, and positive activity. Now, again, as I mentioned, we have a partnership with the province, Ministry of Economic Development, with the Enterprise Center. And that 95% of businesses are made up of small to medium-sized enterprises. That's not just here, that's across the province and the country. So this partnership is critical to promote entrepreneurship, and the staff, they'll conduct one-on-one consultations in regards to business plan, business registration, support, name searches, and incorporation. Also assist with market research and due diligence. We have a reference library where people come in and do some research. And also any type of government programs that are available, they'll share that with also the client. So the other thing with the center, we host a number of seminars. This past year we did 16 seminars, and all range in different in terms of topics to tax plan, business plan, marketing and research. So there's a number of different programs that the staff invite and host these seminars. We also run a number of business programs for young entrepreneurs, Summer Company, which is actually geared toward high school students. We also run business plan competitions, and we also are we work with the Canadian Youth Business Foundation. We're a screening center for that, for potential loans for young entrepreneurs. Also, we're involved with a number of different local and regional business associations. I won't go through all their lists there for you. And we work on a number of different initiatives with those groups. And at the end of the day, I think what you want to do and what the goal is to create an environment for business to thrive. Now, those businesses are focused on running their business, and when they come to City Hall, whether it be for an application or what have you, I think it comes back to customer service and expediting that particular application or plan in an expedient fashion, because time is money, and that's what we try to assist them with. The key considerations going forward right now the OLG is going through a process of modernizing the gaming industry, which could have major implications to Niagara Falls, obviously with two gaming facilities. And so we want to ensure that moving forward that it affects us in a positive way, or as positive as possible. And one of the things that we're hoping through this process that I think council is aware of is an entertainment complex has been identified as an opportunity to create more opportunity and be a catalyst for further investment and support both casino facilities as well as the hospitality industry. As I mentioned, we're still working on the GO-Train. That we see as a real critical link. By 2015, there's going to be a high-speed rail link from Pearson Airport to Union Station. And once that happens, if we can have that link to Niagara Falls, it's a key link to a major, obviously, transportation infrastructure in terms of the airport. So key opportunity for us to link to that through the GO train. Also, as Alex mentioned, there's a CIP moving forward in the southern part of our community in terms of the economic gateway zone. The region is putting together a CIP, and what we want to work on is a bit of a master plan moving that initiative forward and how we're going to market that to various sectors in the future. One of the other issues that we're dealing with that's impacting manufacturers and other sectors of the business community is power, electricity costs, and electricity rates. And we're working with the association going forward. We're working on a white paper right now to present to government, hopefully early in the new year, with them on some ideas on how we can deal with that, how we can mitigate that, because that's a key issue for those businesses. The other thing that we're doing in terms of youth entrepreneurship, we are actually opening up an incubation office, and our enterprise center is going to move right across the street from City Hall. And it'll have 8 offices that actually young entrepreneurs, there'll be a screening process we're going to go through that can set up their business, help them launch the business from that center. And then the other thing that we've talked about in terms of the LEGO transportation system, we're involved working with advisory committee, moving that forward with transportation services. But as part of that process, we were able to get Metrolink through GoBus to be part of our maintenance facility. They're going to invest $5 million toward that maintenance facility, which helps the municipality, of course, keep some of its costs down. So we're going to, again, manage and monitor that.
Okay. Are there any questions of Mr. Felicetti? Councilor Morocco?
For the chair, to Mr. Felicetti, I just wonder, how do we compare with the rest of the region in economic development and growth? Do you have any reports on that?
Well, from a commercial perspective, it's been very positive. I think, especially in tourism, in the last 10 years, it's been $2 billion worth of investment. So from a commercial perspective.
What about industrial?
It's a challenge. I think right across the region, right across the province, it's been a challenge. It will continue to be. Obviously, there's been a lot of movement from manufacturing to go to cheaper jurisdictions, but we haven't given up on it.
Overseas,
like obviously in the Far East, you've seen a lot of movement there. But again, through some of the programs, like we're dealing with the Economic Gateway Zone and Center, we think that could be a real opportunity to mitigate some of that, create an incentive for them to locate there and set up their business there. But again, anything we can do when you have, a lot of our effort is with the companies that we have as well, because how it's structured with the region, they've just gone through a restructuring of their economic development department, that's the group that does most of the external marketing and send the leads down to the municipalities. So they've been in flux the last year because they've gone through this restructuring. So
normally we would actually go in joint ventures with them on economic trade missions to secure business to our region?
They would do those, and then when they get the leads, they'd send them to us because we have the properties, we have the buildings, etc. So once they execute that program, they provide us the lead. It would be more them kind of doing that kind of work.
Thank you, Mr. Conklin.
Sure. Yep, Mr. Tapp? If I could just add in part to that, Mr. Phillips said he alluded to, but it's part of where taking up the council's strategic directions is that the building across the street that we're going into is the small business center. And the whole goal there is, if you look at our industrial base, probably something like under 2%. Mm-hmm. And we know it's very difficult to land that big fish, to get that big industrial operation. But our strategy here is that with this small enterprise operation across the street, incubator opportunities, if we can get young, new entrepreneurs that get in there, start up their own business, they can then get on their feet. If they can then go and hire 2 or 3 people, that's where a lot of the future of the growth in employment is, in sort of smaller scale, kind of commercial or light industrial kind of ventures. So this incubator center over there will hopefully help give those young entrepreneurs a leg up, where they don't have that initial capital investment, get across the street, our staff works with them, gives them a business plan, gives them the business tools, and then they can get out on their own, rent space, hire people, start paying taxes, and, you know, growing the community. So I think Mr. Phillips said he's kind of understated, you know, what we believe the importance of that's going to be in the strategy.
Okay, Councilor Marshall.
Yes, on that point, and I think that's a very good incentive, and thank you very much, Mr. Todd, for giving us that information, as well as the fact that, you know, people constantly ask, you know, where's our industry, and we know it's a struggle, so that's why I asked that question today, because they think that our focus is just on tourism, and tourism is a huge industry here in our region, but we also want to let people know that we're not just trying to work to get more tourism organizations here, but we are also trying to get whatever industry that we possibly can get, or other businesses to our region. Thank you.
Okay, Councilor Mays and Iannone.
Yeah, Mr. Chairman, I'd like to know, Mr. Fellow said he does a great job for us, and I'm just wondering, are we getting that much assistance from the regional tour association, that the tourism organization? I know that's fairly new, it's only been up for a couple of years. Are you getting any assistance from them, or are we active with them? And also, I want to know, too, about the, they used to call it the Niagara Economic Development Committee, and that, and I know the region's gone through some changes. Are they of any assistance to us?
With the RTO, actually, I just joined their development strategy committee, excuse me, but I think they're working closely with the industry. I think, as you said, they've only been around for about a year. They have about a $4 million budget that really focuses on consumer marketing, and I think they work very closely, or should be working very closely, with the two key DMOs, which is Niagara Falls Tourism and Niagara on the Lake. A good portion of their board is made up of Niagara Falls tourism operators, which is a positive thing. So I think it'll start moving in the right direction. They've just got two really good chairs, I understand, so that's real positive.
Perhaps,
chairs, I should say.
Perhaps Councilor Thompson can tell us, too, are we getting our fair share? Because I know a lot of it has to do with the marketing dollars, the destination marketing fee, is that not correct?
Reminds me of a mini regional government. It's taking time. However, I think they have just got an excellent chair, two chairs, both named Thompson, Janet Thompson and Wayne Thompson. So I think we are in a position to really change the direction to a very positive situation towards the city of Niagara Falls. There's $4 million annually that is being spent, and of course, if it wasn't for the RTO, you wouldn't have seen Red Bull Crest Ice. You probably may have seen Melinda, but they helped. They help substantially with Cochrane. So major events is what they're concentrating on. And if you're going to be in a regional situation and you want to market this district, this area, you have to concentrate on Niagara Falls. And I think we're going in that direction as we speak.
So it has been a benefit to us?
Absolutely.
I think the original concern was a lot of our dollars going to go and support parks all across Ontario, but anyway, we are getting our share.
Strictly Niagara region, $4 million, and mainly in marketing, but major blockbuster events is what their objectives and their focus is.
And they're helping Mr. Felicetti, I hope?
I think they're helping tourism and marketing this region substantially, and hopefully it's going to improve. Yeah.
Super, thank you. My last question is, I know a certain amount of our tax dollars have been going to the region, or you call it the NEDC. Are we still spending big dollars over there, and is there any way we can combat any of that?
Yeah, there's as I was mentioning, there's been a restructuring of NEDC. It no longer exists, actually. After a year of assessment, it's now a department of the region. So it's no longer a standalone entity, but a department of the region. And we've been involved going forward in some meetings and how we'll work together with that new department. We see their focus, as I mentioned, being on external marketing. They have the larger dollars to go out and market the region and then provide us those leads that then we can deal with at our level in terms of promoting property, buildings, whatever they might need. So that's what we're hoping for. It's like I said, it's been out of commission for about a year because of the redevelopment. Their budget hasn't been finalized. It's going through the budget process right now, through their budgeting process. But we're hopeful and we're being positive that it'll be a new start, a new opportunity to work together.
But since we're talking about tax dollars, I mean, so are we still sending money over for that purpose? I know it was somewhere around $500,000 in the previous year. Is that not correct? Perhaps Mr. Harrison can help me.
Well, I don't know what the, as Mr. Felicetti was indicating, it's not part of the regional operation. So I'd have to check what the budget says. But the regional, it's part of the regional levy. We collect regional taxes that go to the region. All the properties in this municipality pay taxes to the school board, as you know, and pay property taxes for the region and the city. The department is now funded as part of that regional levy. So I'd have to get back to you exactly what.
So you're not sure whether we're going to get a break or not yet?
Well, I know that the region has passed their expenditure budget, and it's a part of the. It's a department of the region. So I can get back to you with what the cost is compared to what it was in the previous. Yeah,
thank you.
Mr. Fadd, did you want to answer that?
If I could just add a little bit more to that. Now that it's the Department of the Region, what we've done, and actually the CAOs and the five economic development officers from the five largest municipalities were involved in setting up, conceptually we call it Team Niagara, but it's a staff-level group where the CAOs from the smallest seven municipalities, along with the EDOs, gentlemen like Mr. Felicetti and his counterparts, now form a cross-region committee that will meet regularly with the head of the Regional Economic Development Corporation to ensure that there's a consistency and a knowledge across the entire region as to what's happening with economic development activities. That really wasn't happening before. There was sort of this division between sort of the upper tier and lower tier, and that's just being put in place now. We really think that's going to be a step forward to ensure that, you know, if we're having opportunities that we aren't able to get to Niagara Falls or they're not able to get to Welland, that we're not losing them outside of the region, that we're able to work collaboratively and keep them somewhere in the region. So we think that's going to be a big step forward to help that.
Okay, Councillor Morocco and Councillor Thompson.
Just to your point there on the RTO has $4 million that comes in to operate. I'm just wondering, here we are, almost a duplication of services again. Would it not be an opportunity for the regional, or the DMO, the local tourism board, to actually merge with the RTO? I mean, that would be almost a savings of $400,000 from our coffers if that was the opportunity. And, you know, we got that money going over to the region as well, but as you just pointed out, that's a headache itself. Is that correct? So there's $4 million, that's kind of a duplication of the services? If somebody can answer that.
Well, I think I could take a start at it, but the $4 million is aimed towards marketing and, for lack of a better word, blockbuster events. That money does not go towards an administration of our Niagara Falls tourism. So that's sort of a different entity. The money flows from the RTO, which is really money from the province, but they then are just, lack of better words, an allocation for funding requests. So that could be money coming to us for a blockbuster event, but the majority of it's going to promotional activities and not funding a tourism organization like Niagara Falls Tourism. So maybe Mr. Felicetti.
But they do source and go after meetings and conventions as well. It's pretty much the same as the Tourism Bureau organization does as well. I think we've got the room tax coming, and I think that when we started funding, and Councillor Iannone can maybe talk to this too, because I know that was her goal to keep, you know, reducing their funding for a number of years, because we need to get everyone to be self-sustaining stand on their own feet. And then now that we're at budget, so we're just kind of looking at where we're going to be saving. So some of these groups can actually merge together, and then we actually have that opportunity to save. And maybe put those dollars back into some of the programs that Mr. Filippetti says that he's actually having to pay staff to do, such as Red Bull Crush Ice and the Winter Fest of Lights. You've got different events that are taking place. Or actually for some of the conferences that we're now having to try and fund to secure here too. So I think it's just a reallocation of dollars that can actually go back into our budget to help us, or even just improve the roads that are better for the tourists to come here. So,
if I could, you know, just to give, to the chair, give you a sense of context, to really properly market the tourism destination, you know, there's some studies been done, and for a DMO, it's got to be in excess of 15 to 20 million. So the 4 million hardly, scratches the surface, if you will. Plus, between the RTOs and the DMOs, they've gone through and they've kind of looked at different jurisdictions that they're dealing with. So I don't think they're duplicating each other. They're trying to work to leverage the dollar as far as it can go. And I think they're continuing to do that. That's my understanding, being into a couple of meetings. I think they're trying to say, you know, we're going to be involved with this sector. You're dealing with this. Let's work together to kind of move it. Because in terms of the funding, it's still severely short from what the studies we've seen. Like, it really needs to properly market.
The RTO is severely short-funded?
The whole destination, the RTO plus like Niagara Falls, the destination itself, yeah.
Could we actually, if I could ask Serge through the chair, to actually bring back a report? I believe that what's happened through the RTO now, this DMF has been charged. A lot of other municipalities throughout, I know Toronto and Ottawa, have stopped funding their tourism organizations because they already are getting this money coming in. So they've actually said, you know what, we can't continue to give double dipping. So this is double and triple dipping. If they're getting money from the room tax, they're getting room money, or they're getting money from the province to function, then the city said, you know what, we have to step back, and everybody else kind of came up. So I just want to know, like, is that kind of the pattern that's going across all of the province or the country? If you can maybe follow up.
Councillor Thompson.
Well, first of all, they're two separate and distinct organizations. Niagara Falls Tourism looks after the boundaries of the city of Niagara Falls. The regional tourist organization has four employees. There's no duplication as far as effort is concerned, and they concentrate on marketing. They also have a contract or an agreement with the Scotiabank Convention Center, who does the conventions, the MC and IT efforts on behalf of the RTO. I would really, you take a comparison with Toronto, who gets probably about $26 million from the province for their RTO. Ottawa gets $8 million. And we got shortchanged with one of the major destinations in Canada, and we ended up with $4 million. The DMF is collected by the individuals in the city of Niagara Falls, and just in the Fallsview area alone, $1 million goes for the next 15 years to assist the funding of the convention center. They all get together and provide the fireworks throughout the summertime. The Fallsview area alone spends $600,000 on their BIA area for flowers and upgrades and improvements. And they fund the Festival of Lights. It just goes on and on. So they're all, the BIAs are separate and distinct areas. Niagara Falls Tourism is distinct and goes after the conventions. There's a lot of cooperation between all the different groups, but they are separate and distinct. The only good thing that I can tell you about the three organizations, the Fallsview BIA, the Scotiabank Convention Center, and the RTO, or the Niagara Tourism Partnership, all have the same chairman, who is working together to try to pull it all together and to make it all work. But will they all merge into one group? Absolutely not, because there are 11 other municipalities out there who expect the same consideration as there is in the city of Niagara Falls. So they have to be looked after. It's very interesting at the RTO meetings where they look at Niagara Falls in a different light, and it's not always a positive one, and it's a constant struggle because we do not have a majority of people on there to make sure that Niagara Falls is looked after as far as marketing is concerned. So the $360,000 from here, in my opinion, is economic development, the same as you have trying to get industry here. Mr. Filicetti's budget is $555,000. It's economic development, and that's what it's all about. Where's our strength? Obviously, our strength is tourism. Do we give up on industry and commerce? Absolutely not. So we have some person has to walk with two legs. That's what we're doing, concentrating on tourism through Niagara Falls Tourism, and it's done very well. We have, without exception, the best sales staff and management people we've had there in the last 40 years, and I can attest to that. So anyway, anytime somebody wants a report, we can certainly provide one.
Councilor Marco?
Well, just to that point, I still think I've just heard a lot of duplication being, you know, addressed here. And no disrespect, but Councillor Thompson actually is the chair of all three organizations, so I don't think you'd want them to merge because you would obviously lose the position of all three of those positions. So,
well, as a matter of fact, we did want them to merge, and in fact, Niagara Falls Tourism put itself forward at the time and said, rather than forming a new organization, take Niagara Falls Tourism as the basis and make that the regional tourism organization. And the other players within the region, the other 11 municipalities, said, no, we don't want Niagara Falls involved. We want our separate organization, and that's why it exists today. So,
okay. Councilor Martha.
Well, and to that point, then, I guess you'll have to take a real look at the RTO and who sits on that, or the regional tourism organization, because what I hear from the rest of the region, most of the region isn't sitting on it. It's mostly heavily Niagara Falls, and it's very dictated Niagara. So I think that we need to look at merging together to have a stronger pot of money to really sell the entire destination. That's all I'm looking at.
Well, false information again. The city of Niagara Falls does not have a majority. Pardon me? Yeah, well, I'm responding to serious.
That's fine, questions. That's fine. Keep going.
Certainly, the majority of the people from Niagara Falls, they do not have a majority on the RTO. If they did, it would probably be a different situation.
Okay. Are there any other questions of Mr. Filicetti? If not, then the budget matters for tonight are concluded, and I'll ask the mayor to come back up. We'll start our regular planning meeting.
Okay, I'd like to move into our planning matters portion of the meeting and ask the city clerk to introduce the next item on tonight's agenda. Mr. Arafita.
Your Worship, a public meeting is now being convened to consider a proposed amendment to the city zoning bylaw, and this is a revision to the draft plan of subdivision for the former Optimus Park properties. Notice was given by first-class mail in accordance with the Planning Act on Friday, November 9th, 2012, and by posting a sign on the property in question. Anyone who wants notice of the passage of the zoning bylaw amendment to participate in any site plan process, if applicable, or preserve their opportunity to appeal to the Ontario Municipal Board shall leave their name on the sign-in sheets outside the council chamber.
Thank you very much. Mr. Hrlovich, can you explain the purpose and reason for the bylaw amendment?
Thank you, Worship. The application involves 23 acres of land at the northwest corner of Dorchester Road and Morrison. To the north is the Queensway Planet Subdivision. To the south is the Big Box Center, location of Zayers and Home Depot. The application itself, council granted draft plan approval to the Optimus Planet Subdivision in April of this year. The application before you tonight is to amend that draft plan. The revised plan consists of 111 lots for single detached dwellings. The previous plan had 120 lots. This new version has five blocks for your on-street townhouses and one block for block townhouses. There are no changes proposed to the commercial block or to the lands that would be retained by the Optimus. There's a zoning bylaw amendment as well to that subdivision change, which would introduce a new R1D zone, an R3 zone for a portion of the site, and an R4 zone for a portion of the site. The balance of the lands would remain the current R1E zone, the general commercial, and the open space zone. Before you are the two plans. At the top is the plan that was approved in April of this year. On the bottom is the plan that the developer now wishes to propose. The main item that you could see is the orange color in the bottom left-hand corner, which is the block for the block townhouses and the on-street townhouses. The road pattern is essentially the same. The zone changes then that are going along lots 1 to 27 along the north side of the new street, Optimus Lane, are 50% wider than they were previously shown as in the previous plan. They are, however, looking for a 3-meter exterior side yard setback. That would be at Post Avenue and Optimus Lane. They're looking for 45% lot coverage, and a 14-meter setback would be imposed for the three lots that come in contact with the Queen Elizabeth Way. The five blocks for on-street townhouses would be zoned R3. Again, there's some site-specific modifications, a 1.2-meter side yard, a 3-meter exterior side yard, and 55% lot coverage. The block of townhouses, they're looking at an R4 zone there with site-specific provisions for the front yard depth, interior side yard width, the building separation, that is the distance between the rows of townhouses that would be erected, and the minimum floor area. They're actually asking for 1,200 square foot minimum to be introduced into the bylaw. And we just pointed out that Close Avenue is to remain closed except for emergency vehicles. That was one of the conditions previously imposed by council in the previous approval. City staff held an open house with the public on October the 30th. The people in attendance did not raise any objections. However, after the meeting, we did receive a letter of objection regarding the inclusion of townhouses in the subdivision. There are two proposed changes to the conditions. There are actually 42 conditions altogether. Condition one is just basically a reference to say we're now looking at the plan before you rather than the April 20th plan. And then condition 26 is changed, and this is a condition now required by Canada Post, where the developer previously provided the concrete pad, Canada Post provided the community mailboxes. Canada Post now wants the developer pay for the community mailboxes. The planning staff therefore found that the application for the as before you include widened lots for single detached, block of land for townhouses, on-street townhouses. The reduction in the number of units is from 120 to 111, so it's not significant. Location and size of the commercial and parkland blocks remain unchanged. The residents whose properties abut the plan have indicated they're in favor with the revised plan, and most of the conditions are exactly the same, including the one I mentioned for Close Avenue. The revisions provide a better mix of housing in the community and in the subdivision. Lots 1 to 27 are 50% wider. The road pattern is nearly identical. There are no traffic concerns. It conforms with the official plan, and the zoning conforms with the official plan, and the provisions provide appropriate regulations. Therefore, we're recommending that council approve the requested modifications, that the mayor be authorized to sign the draft plan be extended to, or be given for 3 years, and that the application to amend the zoning bylaw be approved as detailed, and that the mayor and clerk be authorized to execute the subdivision agreement. So those are the highlights of this particular application.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ilovich. Any questions from members of council? Okay, seeing none, members. Oh, I'm sorry, Councilor Gates.
Mayor Diaz, yeah, I got a couple questions here. Let me just get back here. On the conditions, on number 15, and they all seem to put this in, so I just want to developer pay the development charges in force at the time of the execution of the subdivision. Just explain so people understand what that means.
Yeah, the city charges development charges is made up of a fee for it goes towards libraries, fire halls, sewers, new roads, sidewalks. All of those make up a component. For instance, the city charge for a single family dwelling is I think it's $10,900. So a portion of that $10,900 is paid by the developer at the time of registration, and the balance of the fee is collected when the builder comes in for his building permit. And then we also collect the regional development charge as well.
Okay, and thanks very much. And number 16, could you explain what that actually means? So it's not very clear when you read it.
The lot 80 is a portion of land that's actually below the extension of Morrison Street, and so therefore we want that dedicated to the city as parkland, and then the balance of the land is actually less than we require 5%, so 5% is 26 acres of land, 23 acres of land to be dedicated to the municipality. The block 80 is smaller than 5% of the total, and so we will take the parkland, and then we'll take the rest of the cash.
Okay, thanks. It's not clear, okay. So I appreciate the explanation, not necessarily for myself, but certainly for the residents. And then on number 42, which was a huge issue for the resident on closing Close Avenue, it's kind of a little play on words there, closing Close Avenue, but I'm wondering, once it's up and built, the residents could come back and ask the council of the day to reopen that, and I'm wondering if would it not be wise to put something in there that's added right into the purchase, that they can't open Close Avenue, and knowing that when they purchased the land.
What do you want to add? Sorry, could you repeat the last part?
Okay, here's, and I don't know if it can happen, but I'm not sure, so I thought I'd ask the question. The council, one of the reasons why they might have approved this particular development, Close Avenue was a very big issue with the council, I believe, and also with the residents. And the fact that they wanted it closed, only open for emergency vehicles. And now, once this development is developed, maybe the residents that had bought all those homes in there may now come to the council today and say, look, there's no way with the extra traffic that's down that way, do we want one exit out of that area? So I'm saying is, as part of the purchase of buying a home in there, that maybe that another bullet be put in there that they realize that the closed avenue is going to be closed, and put it on the, when they purchase the home, so they know. So it doesn't come back to another council and then have it maybe changed.
I suppose it could be put in as a, you know, the developer would have to then include as a condition of anybody wanting to buy a lot in there that they not, that they can't come back to council and ask for that later, although, you know, the final decision really rests with council in any event. Mostly it was the people who live in the Queensway Garden subdivision who wanted the insurance, not, was not going to stop.
Just a concern that I saw there, and I thought I'd raise it so that the residents would be aware of it. Yeah, it might be a good good question. The other thing is, does River Realty now own the land? Is it officially done? Pardon?
I let them speak to that.
Okay. All right. That's all I have for now. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Thompson.
Just regarding Closed Avenue, I think that was the topic of discussion at the time. Much of a concern to the residents. It was put in as an emergency for emergency vehicles, particularly fire, simply because I think that was a recommendation of the fire chief at the time. And to put any other impediment there to have access other than for fire trucks, I think would be a concern. And there would have to be a public meeting in front of the council and the residents at any time to change that. So people who would make that decision on council would be certainly have to answer to the residents in the area. So I'm comfortable with that.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions of members of council? Okay, seeing none. Members of the public are advised that failure to make an oral or written submission at this public meeting will result in the Ontario Municipal Board dismissing any referral that it receives. Failure to sign the sign-in sheets will result in staff rejecting an appeal, as per Section 3419 of the Planning Act. Council will now hear from anyone other than the applicant who wishes to speak to the proposed bylaw amendment. Yes, sir, if you can step forward. And if you can state your name and address for the record, please.
Yes, hello. My name is David Devine. I live at 4468 Queensway Gardens. I'm not objecting to the changes in this subdivision, but I just want to point some things out from the last meeting that we had. The city planner said that Closed Avenue was always meant to be a development of some sort behind there. I checked the library, 1963 map. There were 12 roads off of Dorchester that were left open for future development. Of those 12, Closed Avenue was the only one that didn't get developed because of Optimus Park purchasing land. Those other 11 areas, all the properties that were additioned onto those dead-end streets, those properties were built on the same lot sizes. This property is not being developed that way. Okay, the other issue, someone in council said they would not approve this property unless there were two entrance exits out of there. So I called City Hall, City Planning, because there's a development going in behind the clinic on Morrison Street called Olympic Development, which only has one entrance. According to City Planning, that's allowed because that's a private development. Although there are going to be multiple dwellings in that property, they only have one address, one billing for everything. I don't see where that's possible if we're worried about emergency vehicles going in and out of an area having one entrance when it's a private development, but when it's a public development, you have to have two. I don't understand that at all. And the last issue in regards to the emergency entry for the vehicles, I contacted a company called National Time Equipment, which I also sent an email to City Planning in regards to that. Their equipment operates on emergency vehicle sirens. So as the siren gets within a certain area, the gate automatically opens, so there is no time lost, someone having to get out to unlock anything. And there's two types they can provide. One is solar powered, in case there's no electrical available. And with the equipment installation, it comes in around $6,000. If it's powered by city power or hydropower, $110.
That then would go for approximately $5,000. Again, these work off of all the emergency vehicles, whether it be fire, ambulance, police. No one has to get out of the vehicle. So I have that right here if anyone's interested in it. So I just wanted to point those three things out from the last meeting, that development is not conforming to what used to be the lot sizes, that there's only one entrance in private development, which I don't think is proper, and the fact we do have a way of emergency vehicles entering and exiting without anyone getting out of the vehicle.
Gil, is there any questions of council, first of all, for Mr. Devine? Maybe we can get some clarification on the entrance and exits for a public versus a private development. I don't
know. That's what planning said to me. There's a difference.
Mr. Hrlovich, is there any comment you can give us on that?
Well, I don't know whether you want me to comment on the specifics. I think you might be referring to the site of the old build-all on Portage Road, which, if that's the case, we don't yet have an application. We have been looking at that on a preliminary basis, but we would still be looking at some laneways that would provide alternate forms of access through there. But typically, a street that might be too long, so if it's a private street, then that's treated entirely differently than a public street. But we'd still have to have the development within 150 meters of a second access. So even if it's a private development, still can't be farther away than 150 meters from the public.
So there's still fire code requirements for that.
That development that's going in behind Morrison only has one entrance. I drove down there and double-checked. There are no other exits or entrances off of that development.
Oh, you're referring to the one on Pettit?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, you know, I don't know, that subdivision was approved, I don't know when, in the 60s, it's a pre-existing development prior to our current subdivision regulation.
I think we get our CAO to weigh in on this one.
If I can help out here, there's a number of smaller condominium developments in the city that are privately owned, and there are distances in that property you're talking about. The distance into that is not near what our fire code distances would have been on this development. So, I mean, I live in a very similar thing myself, where it's one entrance in, but the road length is well within the fire chief's distance for single lane. Once you get past that distance, the fire chief requests that you have two entrances. If you're under that distance, one entrance is accepted. And I think the one you're referring to in behind the railroad tracks over off Pettit, the distance into that property is nowhere near what these distances would have been in there, well, and what the requirements are for the fire chief.
Well, what about the one that's being developed right now at Sunderland Waters? There's only one entrance into there right now.
Well, that's been
handled. That's off the Stanley Avenue.
That's been handled through other accesses as well, similar to this.
Is there any questions for Mr. Devine of Council? Okay, sure. Ms. Chief, would you want to weigh in on this one?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Regarding the access, it is true. We want to make sure that we're in compliance with the official plan, and also in dealing with the same distances, so the 150-meter maximum is what we would apply. And turnaround facilities are required for even that distance, so that's the maximum that we're not supposed to exceed. Having said that, there are numerous examples in the city where that has been exceeded in the past, so there are streets that are out there where that has been the case. However, in today's world, we're trying to make sure that we're in compliance with that rule and obligation, because it does provide for better level of safety for the residents. As far as the lifting arm mechanism, I'm not aware of that one. We are certainly willing to take a look at that. We would also have to ensure that there's a manual or mechanical way of bringing that arm up if we needed to, but we're certainly willing to look at it.
Maybe we can grab a that. Very much appreciate you doing some research on that. Councillor Wing?
Our gate to the airside at the airport has the same mechanism where the siren activates it in cases of emergency.
Okay, that's great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else other than the applicant who'd like to address tonight's amendment? Okay, seeing none, Council will now hear from the applicant or his or her representative.
Welcome. Good. Thank you. Good morning, or good afternoon, good evening, Your Worship, members of council and city staff. We've reviewed the planning report as prepared by the planning department, and we're satisfied with the comments within, including the draft plan conditions. So we would respectfully request your approval of the recommendations found within the report. To answer Councillor Gates' question, yes, we do own the land at present. As far as Close Avenue, I would agree with some of the comments that have been made. Ultimately, I think council has the authority to open that up once again if in fact that were to arise at some point in time. So I don't know if there's anything further that we can do. If someone has a suggestion, I'm certainly willing to consider it. But I think ultimately, I think council does have the authority to open that up at some time in the future.
Okay. Are there any questions of council? Okay. Seeing none, thank you very much. Public meeting with respect to the proposed zoning bylaw amendment is now concluded. Councillor, yep. The recommendations 1 through 5 are moved by Councillor Iannone, seconded by Councillor Morocco. Any discussion? Yes, Councillor Pietrangelo.
Thanks, Your Worship. I am in favor of the recommendation. The only question I have is just I think when Councillor Gates tried to ask the question about number 15 and the development charges, what he was meaning to say was the subdivision agreement was executed in 2012 and some of the buildings didn't get built until, let's say, 2014-2015. Which development charge rate did they pay? The 2012 rate when the subdivision agreement was executed, or the 2014-2015 rate when the building permit was issued? I think that was the question.
It's quickly, it's the fee that's in place at the time. So at the time the subdivision agreement is registered, it's the fee that's in place there. If the fee changes between now and when a building permit's taken out for a specific lot, it will be the new development charge or the charge that's in effect at that time. So if that changes over the next year, it's the fee that's in charge at the time that the permit's taken out.
Okay. So we'll call the vote. Yes, Councillor Gates.
Yeah, Mayor Diodati. Just on a question that I'm concerned from a letter that was received, I would think, by the new Target store that's at the back of the...
Mm-hmm.
And they talk about that they've been approved for another 25,000 square feet over and above what the Walmart is. And I'm just wondering, and then in addition, they talk about the expansion area, and then they talk about the application of the new Target and the area traffic. And I'm wondering if with the problem that I think we're going to have there with potential subdivision in Chef Boyardee, this subdivision, the CN Railway that is, as we all know, is a problem almost on a daily basis with how long the trains are sometimes, and then the Target. So I'm wondering, have we had any discussion with any of them on who's going to pay for the extra roads we're going to need to handle the traffic that's going to be back down in that corner? It's been pretty good the last 2 years. We haven't had Walmart. But now that you're going to have a Target store that's even bigger and maybe potential of more buildings, there may be a huge cost to the city to put the necessary roads in there. I'm wondering if we've had any dialogue with Target at all on what their responsibility would be for making sure that area is okay.
Mr. Hrlovich, so the question, obviously, we're looking at traffic studies and or controls with the increased volume. So if that's the case, have we looked at that? Have we done the study? And also, who would be paying if there was to be any controls put in place?
We're still working with Target on their with their traffic engineer on whether or not there would be any additional traffic volumes, and they would be responsible for the percentage of their contribution to that additional traffic. So they would be looking at the amount of traffic flowing out of the Optimus Park subdivision, what they're contributing, and what the overall impact is down the road. The commercial blocks that's shown in this Optimus Park. Mm-hmm. At site, at the time of site plan approval, they would be required to submit a traffic study. And again, if there's additional traffic that flows out of that commercial development relative to the traffic that can be accommodated at the intersection, mm-hmm. there's some upgrades, they would pay their proportional share. So if they step-by-step or incremental kind of change, but we'll be working with each of the developers as they come through with their proposals. I don't know if that adequately addresses it.
Yeah. Councilor Gates?
I'll just finish up, because I know Councilor Thompson wants to say something. I don't think the word is if there's going to be more traffic. There will be more traffic. I mean, let's call a spade here, and I just want to make sure, and I'm glad that you're telling me that you are on top of it, on particular on them maybe having to pay for the upgrades, because there is going to be an increase in traffic. I don't think, I'm not so sure if was the right word, but that's fair. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Councilor Thompson?
Well, I'm glad this was mentioned, because it's not if. I think if the this development takes place, Target goes ahead, the development goes over on the old industrial property, we're going to have a worse chaos than we had 5 years ago before Walmart left. This is going to be, in fact, how many debates we had around this table regarding a, at that time, 5-6 years ago, $15 million overpass at Morrison Street. I would suggest that we should be doing a lot of study and putting effort in to find out where we're going with this situation. And I would suggest to you the Railroad Relocation Committee that has been rather dormant in spite of Mr. Isipon's constant harassment of everybody to get this thing moving, because he does have some good suggestions regarding the possibility of relocating the rail line that's going through the center of the city. It doesn't stop anywhere. It doesn't go to any industrial sites. It just goes through the city up to Fort Erie and over into Buffalo and in the state. There's a solution to this. It's either overpasses, which are going to cost us probably $100 million in several places, or a relocation of the rail line. But right on. This is going to be a huge traffic jam as soon as all of this development takes place. Positive development, but it still has to move, and I don't think we're ahead of the game at all. I think we have a real serious problem that's going to exist if we don't react to it. Railway relocation or overpass. My hope is there can be some railway relocation, not only for this area, but for all of these rail lines blocking up the emergency access for fire and emergency personnel. It's a natural, and I think it can be done. It's been done before.
Okay, are there any other comments? Okay, so we're going to call the motion on the five recommendations. Moved by Councilor Iannone, seconded by Councilor Morocco. All those in favor? Okay, opposed?
Yes.
With one opposed. All right, thank you very much. Okay, thank you. Moving on to PD 2012-75, I'd ask the city clerk to introduce the next item on the agenda.
Your Worship, a public meeting is now being convened to consider a proposed amendment to the city zoning bylaw to permit a used car lot at 5990 Thorolstone Road. Notice was given by first class mail in accordance with the Planning Act on Friday, November 9th, 2012, and by posting a sign on the property in question. Anyone who wants notice of the passage of the zoning bylaw amendment to participate in any site plan process, if applicable, or preserve their opportunity to appeal to the Ontario Municipal Board shall leave their name on the sign-in sheets outside the council chamber.
Okay, now I'll ask our Director of Planning, Mr. Hrlovich, to explain the purpose and reason for this proposed bylaw amendment.
Thank you, Your Worship. This application involves a parcel of land on the south side of Thorolstone Road, east of Carroll Avenue. It's almost opposite Cinex Avenue. The lands to the north are used for retail purposes. On the east and west of the subject site are lands used for automotive commercial uses, and to the south is an industrial use. The property has an area of about 0.4 of an acre of land. The proposal is to basically change the, excuse me, the zoning from general industrial to light industrial in order to accommodate a car dealership lot on the property. The they would be using the existing building and the existing entrance from Thorold Road. They're proposing within the light industrial zone a site-specific 1.5-meter-wide landscape strip at the spot frontage, and then a strip of land along the west property line, along the back, along the south property line, with a total of 18% of the lot to be landscaped. They're seeking two site-specific setbacks for the existing building on the site, a side yard setback of 2 meters and a rear yard setback of 3.7 meters. And then they wish to recognize the existing lot frontage of 19.5 meters, 64 feet, and the existing lot area of 1,600 square meters, about 0.4 of a hectare, which are smaller than the standard light industrial zone. As I said, the zoning amendment is to actually change the land from general industrial, which does not permit a car lot, to a light industrial zone, which allows less intensive industrial uses, but also includes a used car lot. We had a neighborhood meeting on October the 25th. No one was in attendance. However, we did receive one telephone call from the abutting landowner to the south of the with the industrial property, and they were requesting that there be a chain link fence placed across the rear of the property. So on the bottom of the slide, they're looking for a chain link fence that would go there to block any traffic that might move across that property line into their industrial area. This property won't be subject to site plan control because basically it's using the existing site. So if council decides to accommodate the industrial property owner, we would have to include that as a zoning requirement. The lands are designated for industrial purposes. The official plan says that industries with similar characteristics should be grouped together. This is an area where there's transitioning from heavy industrial uses to lighter industrial uses, and the proposed car lot would not conflict with any of the neighboring commercial uses. The zoning bylaw is again consistent with that transition from heavy industrial to light industrial and gives the city a better business image. The requested light industrial zone is actually exactly the same as the GM dealership to the east, the Toyota dealership to the west, and so in fact is compatible with the abutting land uses. The amendment can be supported therefore because it is designated industrial. The used car lot is compatible with the types of uses that are already in the area. Therefore, staff has recommended that council approve the zoning amendment application before you tonight with the site-specific provisions that I outlined. Those are the highlights.
Thank you, Mr. Ilovich. Any questions of council? Councilor Thompson?
Well, isn't this already used as a storage for parking cars and whatever, as we speak?
It is. If you use the air photo that's at the beginning of the slide presentation, does show that there are a number of cars that believe it's owned by Autoline Toyota, and they've been storing vehicles there, although they've been going through this application process for a while.
We're going to go for a Christmas thing. We could have done without that before. This is a no-brainer, in my opinion. If we close the meeting, maybe we can get on and approve this. It's already being utilized for that, and it fits in with the entire street.
Thank you, Eagle Eye. Any other questions from anyone else on council? Okay, seeing none, are there anyone in the audience that wishes to speak to this other than the applicant? Okay, seeing none. The applicant, is there anything, Mr. Allen, welcome. Is there anything you wanted to add to tonight's excellent report?
It's identical to the one we did about a year and a half ago. The only comment is on the chain link fence. I don't see the need for it. the building itself blocks all access to the site from the back area from the south. So, and Councilor Thompson, yes, it's used for storage. The purpose for the rezoning is they cannot sell vehicles legally on that site without it being zoned properly. So they don't sell right now, they just don't.
All you have to do is put it for sale.
So, do we have any comment, Mr. Ilovich, on the chain link fence, if it's blocked by the building, what the necessity of that is?
We're going to require landscaping in that area in any event, so I think the, between the building and the landscaping, the access should be blocked.
Okay, so it should be locked, and a site plan that'll be dealt with, a, or there's no site plan. So, so is there a requirement for a fence, or...
I'm agreeing with the applicant in this case that it's not.
Gotcha, gotcha. So you're good with that then, Mr. Allen?
Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. I will now close the public meeting. Looking for a motion by Councilor Thompson, second by Councilor Pietrangelo. Any discussion of the motion? All those in favor? Thank you very much. Now I ask the city clerk to introduce the next item on the agenda.
Your worship, we have one of our favorite topics, the cellular towers, telecommunication facility. I'll read my blurb. Industry Canada is responsible for licensing and approvals for telecommunication equipment and facilities across Canada. Industry Canada has a mandatory consultation process that requires the proponents to consult with local landowners and land use authorities like the city prior to construction of the facility. Although this is not considered a public meeting under the Planning Act, as part of the consultation process, City Council will hear from any interested parties, the proponent if necessary, and will consider the staff recommendation report. So this is in relation to 5499 Kaler Road. A representative of the applicant is here and does have a presentation if necessary. I would suggest that we've had these in the past. I would suggest maybe the mayor see if there's any public that are interested, have them speak first, and then if necessary, we can have the applicant speak.
Sounds good to me. Is there anybody here from the public in regard to this item? Yes? Okay. All right, great. Well, maybe we'll have the applicant to... can we answer that question? Michalovich, where on Kaler Road?
It's the auto wrecking yard on the west side of Kaler Road, right at the railway track, opposite Hodgson Steel.
Yes?
The no, it's in the grounds that of the auto wreckers. The they're proposing that be up near the street. We're recommending that it be shifted to the back of the property away from the residential uses, because we had a number of residents that came forward during the public consultation that objected to it next to their houses.
Okay. Do you want to come up to the mic, Ms. Grandoni? It's hard to hear you. Sorry.
I didn't come for this, but if you're going to the back, how close to the forest are you? There's a piece of wetland there.
We've got a comment by the clerk.
Yeah, in light of Ms. Grandoni's comments, it's probably appropriate to hear from the applicant, especially since, as Mr. Hurlovich notes, what staff's recommending is different from what the applicant is proposing, so maybe we should hear from the applicant now and then deal with it after that.
Okay, and then if you have any questions. Okay, we'll now have the agent or the applicant who will provide an overview to the proposal. If you'd please state your name.
Good evening. I'm Sean Olivey. I'm here with Summit Telecom Services on behalf of Rogers. I can run through this whole thing if you'd want. We started off, I was told we'd be doing a presentation, but seeing how things are going, I don't know if you need me to go through the whole thing or just explain what's happened since the recommendation.
Yeah, why don't you give us the abbreviated version?
Okay, so I'll skip through this quickly. We're just sort of the background, as you know. Industry Canada is the final approval authority, but we're required to consult with the local land use authority and public. So we went through this process regarding the original location, which I don't know if this mouse shows up in here, which was proposed by Rogers in here. This is just the original coverage before any new site was proposed. And these other sites are existing Rogers sites. So they are optimally going for this dark blue, which is coverage in and out of buildings. Light blue is similar. Green will probably work in your car and outdoors. Beyond that, yellow and red is fringe or no coverage. So they're really looking to join these sites, increase their reach and also their capacity, offloading the other sites. So that would look like this if they could fit it in the area they require. We're constrained pretty much to this search area, which is given to us by Rogers. So outside of that, which is why we would normally not try to be too close to residential, but we have to work within what we're given. So looking at that area from above, you can see we can't really go too much further south or on this side or that side. We just get closer and closer to residential. So calling a couple of the landlords in there, once of course we determined that we couldn't use a rooftop or existing tower, this was our first response. The reason we went to this corner as opposed to closer to the back, the auto record yard, I believe there's a fence that runs through here, and in terms of access and security for after hours at the auto record, they didn't want people trying to get back there. I believe they had security dogs and things of that nature. It was just sort of complicated. We did go through the consultation procedure. We received some comments, a couple at the public meeting where there were three attendees and two more in writing. We responded to and also provided time for them to respond back to us, which we never received any responses after our initial response. And then from the review of the planning department, they asked if it would be possible, in light of those concerns, and also two setback requirements, the rear and side yard setbacks, if we would be able to move from our initial proposed location to the back. As I mentioned, there's a couple constraints to that, but we have spoken to the landowner again, and he's willing to renegotiate the current contract we have with him and work something out so that we can move it back there. That way we can work with planning department, and also it nearly doubles the distance from residential initially proposed. And also to answer that question that was brought up earlier, we will not be in any forest. We're still in the auto wrecker yard, so that hopefully isn't an issue for anyone.
Okay. Any questions of council for Mr. Ogilvie? Okay, seeing none. We'll now hear from anyone other than the applicant. So any questions of anyone here other than the applicant? Okay, seeing none. Are there any further questions of council? Then the public meeting is now concluded. We have a motion from council. Councillor Iannone, move the recommendation, seconded by Councillor Kerrio. Any discussion to the motion? All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Here we have a property matter, L-2012-22, permanently closing and declaring surplus land. Do we have anyone here that has an interest in this matter? Okay, Ms. Grandoni? Did you want to come forward and address the council, and we can get you answers to questions you may have?
I have a copy for the clerk.
Okay. Does everybody have a copy of the letter? Okay.
Mr. Chairman and members of council, there's a few more. Is there some left over at Councilor Morocco's that should go to someone else, please? Thank you. Mr. Chairman, members of council, I am opposed to closure of this road as it is being done to encourage non-farm use, such as a quarry or housing, etc., in an agriculturally designated area. A tender fruit orchard existed on the north of Uppers Lane years ago, but it was pulled out by people who previously who were trying to use it for an industrial use, which would have been illegal at the time. This area is outside the urban boundary as established by the Ontario Municipal Board decision of 1979, which proved that the area between Niagara Falls and Thorold has capability for grapes and fruit. Whatever the reason, closure is premature, as nearby development in Thorold will impact traffic numbers. It would increase the need to keep this Uppers Lane open, not closed, so as to reduce traffic intermittently on Highway 20 and the dangerous Beaver Dams Road. Now, I just got the report, so I have a few comments, and I didn't get them into my letter because I was relying on my computer and it became a nightmare, so I ended up having to get this from the city. I have a couple of comments on the report. Walkers can make application without closing the road. He doesn't have to own the road in order to quarry. So that's not holding him up. There's a comment at the bottom that says city strategic commitment. It says the proposed transaction is in keeping with council's commitment to financial sustainability, customer service excellence, organizational efficiency and effectiveness, and the creation of a well-planned city. Well, I say, what about a well-planned agriculture community? I know one thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the province and the federal government and ask to have agricultural land use planning removed from the local people, because it just isn't being done. It is not. It's well planned for urban use, but it's not well planned for agriculture use. It's based on false mapping. When we had the hearings in 1979, the same witnesses for Thorold testified for Niagara Falls. In fact, the climate evidence was blanket evidence, and the climate in Niagara Falls is stronger than that than Thorold. This belongs in the green belt, and if it was, you wouldn't be able to quarry it. So everything is proceeding. The assault on the agriculture community is proceeding based on false mapping. That's not fair play. Now, I was talking to someone that lives on Uppers Lane, and I don't, I'm referring to a resident, not an institution. And he was of the opinion he'd be able to stay in his house, I gathered, for quite a while. And yet it says here, the transaction should involve a condition that the existing dwellings be demolished so that there will not be a zoning violation created by the closure of the road. And I'm wondering if the people that are renting there have been notified of this condition. And I have another two questions. Was the Federation of Agriculture notified? And on page 2, analysis rationale, it says it is clear from the tone and wording of their offer that they are aware that the process of acquiring this land will involve further procedures. What are they? and they should be listed here for people to know. So those are two questions that I have.
Okay, and you made reference to false mapping. Are you specifically referring to the map in the report?
No, to the agricultural land-based map of the region, which is the basis for this getting advanced.
Okay.
Because it should be good grape and good fruit. A stronger designation, the weaker designation of good general allows you to destroy more.
And so your two questions, one is Federation of Agriculture.
Were they notified?
And secondly, the tenant in the house there, were they contacted or notified, you're asking as well?
That everything's going to be torn down in order to satisfy this sale. That's the way I understand it. The other question I had, analysis rationale on page 2, it says there's more to the process, further procedures, and I think that we should be made aware of what they are.
Okay.
Because it's not listed in the
report. Okay, we'll get some answers. We'll start off with our solicitor, Mr. Beeman, if you could help us address some of the questions.
Well, I think I should start by just saying that we can't revolutionize the law overnight to satisfy the person's interest. The control over land uses remains with the local government, and that's the way the province of Ontario has been set up. We can't relitigate the case from 1979, and we can't amend the mapping to suit this person. As far as the three specific questions, we don't notify lobby groups. Federation of Agriculture is a lobby group. They're not a designated person to be notified in the case of closing a road, and there's no reason whatever to do so. At law, they're not even, they wouldn't be notified if this was a rezoning or an official plan amendment, because they're a lobby group, they're not an official organization that's required to be notified. As far as the closing of a road only requires notifying the people we have notified, and that's been done. So far as the tenants of the buildings are concerned, well, we only have hearsay as to what the person actually said and what the person's understanding is. So I'd really be reluctant to start planning, to making plans for council based upon what some unidentified person said. But in any event, the buildings don't have to be demolished tomorrow in the arrangements that we have in mind here. And certainly if somebody needs to be accommodated, I'm sure we could get together with the Walkers and work something out to extend the time for keeping the building up. But I think Walkers can, there are representatives of Walkers here, and they can speak to the issues of notifying their tenants. As far as further hearings, this particular matter is going to be likely, if they do intend to proceed with the quarry, there's a whole series of hearings that are required to open a quarry. Among other things, there's going to have to be hearing pursuant to the Quarries Act. That will probably be confined to the official plan hearing, and in some cases, there's actually environmental assessments that go along with them. What exactly the procedures would be for this particular quarry depend on what comes out of the initial reports that are filed at the time they make their application and what conditions are found. For example, just an example, the Nelson Quarry in the city of Burlington required additional procedures for the Environmental Protection Act because there turned out to be Jefferson salamanders in the area. So an additional jurisdictional issue arose in that particular case. It's unlikely such a thing would happen here, but I can't give an exhaustive list of all of the procedures that will be required here. The one, what is clear to me is that they'll need a quarry license procedure, they'll need an official plan amendment, they'll need a rezone. All of those things are public processes, and I am sure that Walkers will make every effort to comply with all public notice requirements in order to facilitate those proceedings.
Thank you. Yes?
He's answering with regard to the whole quarry designation, and I believe the comments here, acquiring this land is referring to the road. That's what I wanted to know. What further procedure to acquire the road closure will involve further procedures?
I cannot respond to Ms. Grandoni's interpretations of the document. I have provided the answer to what I was referring to when I drafted it.
This is a question. It is clear from the tone and wording of their offer, and that's the offer to buy the land, that they are aware that the process of acquiring this land will involve further procedures. What further procedures? Maybe I can get it in writing.
I'm simply not going to respond any further. I think Ms. Grandoni's had her answer.
And if I could respond to the comment about you can't change this designation overnight, 1979, that's about 40 years you've had to get the designation right. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Is there anyone else here other than the applicant to address tonight? Okay, then we'll invite the applicant. What's that? Okay, well, so we've got a report before council here. We do have the applicant in the audience if you have any questions. Are there any further questions of council? Yes, Mr. Beamer?
Just one thing that I wanted specifically to address, and this has to do with concerns. I believe there are representatives here of the Bible Baptist Church of Niagara, who own a property that is accessed off there. They just wanted to be sure that I would publicly assure everyone, and talk to Mr. Graham to make sure he also wanted me to do this, that their entrance will not be closed off. This road will not be closed until satisfactory arrangements are made with the church to deal with their access. So the bylaw to close the road will not be presented today. It will be presented at such time as the church indicates to the city that a satisfactory arrangement has been made with respect to their entranceway. Negotiations are well underway between the church and Walker's, and it's expected that there will be a resolution shortly, but it's just not in place as we speak today.
Okay. Everyone understand? Okay. Yes, Councillor Iannone? We're looking for a motion. Okay, motion by Councillor Iannone to move the recommendation. Looking for a second. Councillor Kerrio, any discussion to the motion? Yes, Councillor Gates?
And your dear daddy. I always have concerns when I see the appraisal value of land that we own, and then what we're selling to Walker's is, in my eyes, substantially less than the appraised value. I did read the comments on the back page two, and also read the comments that the Walker Industries, who were at the view that the city's appraisal was very high. I find it always interesting that the city seems to buy land high and sell low. I've always said that. I've asked for a report on having somebody handle the real estate of the city of Niagara Falls for this very reason. Walker's is probably, in my eyes, and I may be wrong, they're probably one of the richest companies in all the Niagara region, bar none. And the fact that they won't pay the appraised value is really upsetting to me. Unless they are willing to agree to pay the appraised value, I certainly won't be voting for it. And I've read the reason. I've read the other ones. I think I even voted against those as well. But this just, here you have a company that certainly can afford to pay the appraised value, and they're choosing not to. And I don't think the taxpayers of Niagara Falls would be impressed with that.
Okay, yes, Councilor Morocco.
Your Worship, I have to say that I'm not going to support the recommendation. I think that we have a letter also from a farmer that has some concerns. I think I just don't have enough information. I'm not too sure why we have to declare these roads surplus. I'm just not understanding why it has to be done at this time, especially when people are opposed. And I have to say I support Ms. Grandoni this time on her comment.
Mr. Beamon, is there a timely nature to this report for tonight, or is there any comment on that?
I think that I would leave that to be addressed by the Walker Brothers, because they're the ones who have come to us to buy the land. The city is not in charge of their process. So they're the ones that want to conclude the transaction. They're the ones who come asking to buy the land. They're the ones that are scheduling things. So if the representatives from Walker's here, and they can explain to council why they need to proceed in the way they did.
Okay. We've got some representatives from Walker. Maybe you could, if you could introduce yourself.
Sure.
And maybe address the question, that'd be helpful.
Yeah, I'd be happy to do that. My name is Peter Graham, Director of Business Development at Walker Industries. Appreciate the opportunity, Mr. Mayor and Council Member, to address the group here. To make a really long story short, there is a group of land holdings that have been acquired over many, many years, probably in the order of about 8 years, the last 8 years, with the intent to move forward for development. And it, I wouldn't think it'd be any surprise for anybody here that it's a replacement quarry operation. It'd be a quarry application ultimately that would come forth down the road to replace our existing operation in Thorold, Ontario. So we proceeded with that, and then basically the last piece of the puzzle, next to finalizing a very recent negotiation with the Bible Baptist Church, which is still ongoing, so I don't want to go into details on that. But the other piece on that is the road, and Uppers Lane in particular basically bisects this subject land, which is about 250 acres. So I didn't really want to go into a lot of the detail in terms of our discussions with Ken Beeman, city solicitor, in terms of appraised value and what we came forth in terms of a comparative analysis as well. Basically a bit of a difference in terms of what the appraiser came up with in terms of what we came up with. We're okay to pay market value, and we believe we're actually paying more than that. But taking a step back, basically why we're kind of trying to push this process forward in terms of timing now is that we were fine to actually even wait until we actually obtain a license to trigger the acquisition of the road. That's fine. But basically the communication back, the way it would work legally, is that then this process would be initiated at that point, whether it's 5-7 years down the road, at which time we could say, well, sorry, you don't meet the requirements, we can't close the road, and therefore all the time and money that's been put into it is basically shut down the project. So we thought, well, let's move the process forward now. We'll come to an agreement in principle, acquire the land now, and then have it in hand. We'd assume the liability of the road and probably have to close off a portion of it for liability reasons and move forward that way, and then look to obtain a license. Basically switch up the process a little bit in terms of timing. But so that's basically our story in terms of why we wanted to move things ahead forward now. We're not a huge rush in terms of the overall licensing application that comes down the road, but we can't leave this as a risk to our investment out, you know, 5-7 years down the road where rules could change, things could change.
Okay. Councilor Morocco?
Yes, Your Worship. Through you to Mr. Graham. Mr. Graham, I'm sorry, I just would feel a little bit more comfortable because you said you were still in negotiations with the church.
Yes.
And there's still a property owner here that has submitted a letter to of his concerns, and he's obviously, he hasn't been approached or he's not happy with what's going on. I think he needs to be addressed. So I think, as far as I'm concerned, I would like to make sure that the church negotiations have been fulfilled, if that's the case, if they're happy, and the neighbors, abutting neighbors, are also okay with this. I'm not willing to support it unless I know that's in place. So if they are looking to come back another time, I'll consider it.
That's generally okay with my perspective. It's just whether we could even put it forward on based on those conditions being met, or but I'm fine to readdress it as well.
Mr. Beeman, the concerns that have been put in the letter from the neighbor are all matters that would be dealt with during the process of the official plan amendment and the quarry application. They really aren't affected one way or the other by the road. It's tied into the road in this person's thinking because the road is a part of the process to acquire a quarry. But all of those issues have to do with the externalities of a quarry, an existing quarry, the traffic, the dust and so on, the buffers around it. Those are all matters that are addressed at the hearings that actually establish and license the quarry. Is that not right, Mr.
Correct.
As far as the other thing, I think might give the council some assurance. During the course of our negotiations, Mr. Graham showed me that the region sold land very close to here for exactly the price per acre that we're proposing here. And they have the, you know, an internal real estate department and all that sort of thing too. This is the price that ultimately we agreed at, which is, I think, considerably closer to where I was than where our peers started.
Yeah.
Okay, Okay, yes, Councillor Gates?
Well, just on that, Mr. Beaman, I got a document delivered to my house, and it says very clearly what the appraisal rate is. And the appraisal rate is what it is. And you know, your negotiations with Walkers is one of the reasons why I continue to say that we need somebody to handle real estate for the city of Niagara Falls. That's why I raised this issue. The appraisal, I can only go by what's in print and what I read. And I also read what his comments were on the back, that he felt the appraisal was too high. That's what the documentation that I was provided with tonight, and that's how I end up making my decision. So my decision is clear that if the appraisal rate is what it is, and the Walkers Industries, or Walker Brothers, or whatever you guys are, want to purchase the land, then pay the appraisal rate that is for the council. That's been my issue. I continue to say that we continually seem to buy high and sell low. No disrespect to you guys, but I believe that you can certainly afford the 55, the appraisal rate. Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Councillor. We've got Councillor Thompson, Councillor Morocco.
Well, I think you indicated that, like, this is 5-7 years down the road. There's kind of an indication that this is imminent. They're going to start digging. We have the whole process regarding the rezoning, regarding the quarry application. This is going to take years down the road. So I think there's been a suggestion that you would be happy with a motion which included finalizing the agreement with the church and notification of the gentlemen, the people in the house that have expressed concerns. They knew it was 5 or 7 years down the road. I don't think they'd be too concerned. So I think that's the solution to the problem.
Okay, Councillor Morocco.
I'd like to make a motion to defer until we get all this these questions answered.
We have a motion for deferral. Is there a seconder? Councillor Mays?
No, I just want to agree with that too, Your Worship. I think probably we should be looking at...
He hasn't made the motion yet.
I think we should be deferring this too. We need a copy of these appraisals. We've got a very poor map in our handout. We don't know the situation fully with the church people and everything else. And I just basically, I think we need some more information. I think we should defer this.
Okay, just before you make
take
that
another
motion,
look at it.
Just before you make that second, can we ask the clerk to...
Council's reminded that the appraisals were brought to your attention at an in-camera session in September.
Okay, so we've got a motion for deferral. Are you making a second, Councillor?
That's an important point. The price of this land was already settled at the last meeting, right? So that you've already agreed to this price back in September, when the in-camera report was presented and it had the same information as to how the price was arrived at.
Do you understand? So in camera September 11th, Councillor, we did deal with this, and we did ratify an open council. So I mean, you still have the option to defer, but that issue, we should address that it was dealt with at the September meeting.
Your Worship, it's not based just on the property. It's also based on the church and the owners around there. Make sure that the deals are done with the church and the owners are happy, or the property owners are okay with it.
Okay. So we have a motion for deferral by Councillor Morocco. Do we have a seconder for deferral? Yes, Councillor Mays? Okay. That motion is non-debatable. We'll call the vote. All those in favor? Okay. It's deferred. Okay. Thank you. Okay. So we'll deal with it in the new year. Okay, we'll move on to the mayor's remarks. They're brief tonight. Pardon me? Yes, Merry Christmas. They're quick. First off, we have obituaries. We'd like to first offer our condolences to Lisa Antonio in finance, who lost her father, Gino Gatto, and also to Michael I am Pietro, father-in-law of John Grubich, supervisor of traffic planning, who passed away. Our condolences. We have special announcements, and first off, I'd like to say our new official... Yes, yes, Councillor Peter Angelo?
And just under obituaries, Your Worship,
Teresa Fabro, who lost her grandmother as well.
Yes. I'm sorry. Okay, we're sorry to hear that, Teresa. But another obituary, and our condolences. Councillor Dunn?
This is Napoli.
Napoli. Thank you for that. Special announcements. Niagara Mist Perfume is now here. For those of you looking for that stocking stuffer, made right here in Niagara, I'm going to pass this around. Councillor, CAO Todd has been spraying it every day, so I would ask that he pass this along to the rest of the council. Please pass it along, please, and let everyone smell it. This is a product being marketed by David and Alana D'Angelo of Trivium Industries. It's a unisex fragrance. They sell it at their perfume store, World Class Fragrance on Falsey Boulevard. It's made and designed in Miami. It's got a real neat smell, actually. It's got kind of a cedar smell to it. It's a very interesting smell. We're sure it's going to be very, very popular. What do you think, Mr. CAO? How do you like the smell? Hey, isn't that great? So we're passing that around. Here's the box. So for anybody that's looking for this, go down on Falls Boulevard, and you can buy it there. It's $45. It's being offered. And you know what's great? If you're traveling, it's easy to pack, and it's a neat gift to take the mist smell. Anybody that wants to smell in the audience, by all means, we can all have a smell. Also a reminder that the Niagara Falls Lions Club Christmas tree sale is ongoing. Get down there and get your fresh Christmas trees. Lindis Farm Theater Projects, It's a Wonderful Life, is still playing at the Seneca Theater until December the 16th. Be sure to pick up your tickets down on Queen Street. New Year's Eve, free concert with ET Canada and some of Canada's biggest superstars, Nelly Furtado, Headley, and Dragonette. For any questions, go on the niagaraparks.com/New Year's Eve. Check out the details. Quickly recapping, Red Bull Crashed Ice took place. It was an off-the-charts event. We want to thank all the community, all the council for getting involved, our partners, the parks, the Niagara Parks Commission, the tourism industry, and of course, Skyline Tower, city and the province. Big event. It was off the charts in terms of its social media. It was the highest rated show that they've had so far in terms of the kickoff to the event. We're very happy, and our goal is our economic development officer is working closely with them to look at a long-term agreement, and that's what our hopes and our plans are. I want to thank Councillor Gates for attending Angels Everywhere at Christchurch. I want to thank him as well for joining me at the Niagara Concerts event on Saturday night for Michael Chufo. Excellent performance. We had a grand opening and ribbon cutting of Once Upon a Child, where they recycle kids' clothing and items. I was joined by Councillors Thompson and Iannone. Thank you for being there for that. We had grand opening of Designer Delights Cupcakes on Portage Road. Very tasty delights, and for those of you that are having birthday parties or special events, get down there. Great products. Also had a grand opening of Audrey and Company Hair and Aesthetics on St. Paul Street. We want to congratulate the 9 2012 firefighter recruit graduates. We graduated them officially last week with the chief, and we want to welcome them to the city and to the team. And as well, while we're on the firefighting topic, I'd like to, it was brought to my attention by the chief tonight, that there are the 12 days of Christmas fire safety that will now be highlighted on the city's website starting tomorrow. And every day there will be a new message, so we encourage all parents and their kids to get on niagarafalls.ca. And I'll give you a little tip. The very first one tomorrow will be water your fresh trees daily. As you know, they will dry out. They can become combustible. Go on the Niagara Falls website every day, and you'll get the 12 days of the holidays as we celebrate safety. That was a different one. Thank you for that. Also, what's new? Two last announcements. Number one, TVCOGECO is now transitioning to high def. The launch is happening this week, and what that means is you'll be able to catch the TVCOGECO TV show of council on channel 700. In high def. So guys, get on your makeup. They're going to see all of our imperfections much closer. That's right, absolutely. So high def, TVCOGECO. Also, the grand opening of Chippewa Pet Store will take place December the 15th. We'll look forward to it. And as well, the council, I want to say you all look very festive. I see some green shirts, see some red ties, gold ties, lots of festive colors. I was told, looks like this is an altar in church with my two candles up here. I want to say to, from council, to all the residents and to all the staff and from all the staff of the city, we want to wish health and happiness to everyone throughout the city and the region that follow us. Wish them a very, very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year as we'll come back in the new year for our next council meeting. So that concludes the mayor's announcements for tonight. Moving on to communications and comments of the city clerk. First off, okay, we got a motion by Councilor Thompson. We're not there yet, but we will. Moved by Councilor Thompson, seconded by Councilor Iannone, that FX Works Incorporated wanting to do fireworks off the Skyline Tower for New Year's Eve. Yes, Councilor Mays?
I'm just concerned, Your Worship, I don't see where there's any mention that there's fireworks or insurance or hold harmless for the city. I know that in the past we always had that. Can someone tell me, is that in place? Did anybody get a copy of the insurance? They normally do.
Mr. Beeman, can you comment on that one?
No.
I don't know. I really don't know anything about
it. Should we have one?
Mr. Clerk?
Generally, we do get one. And it's usually
a resolution. I would think that's an automatic, yeah. And we would make it subject to the proper insurance. The reason why this comes to council is more related to the fact that you have a bylaw in place that dictates when fireworks can go off. So that's what the approval are that you're giving tonight. The fire department is involved in inspections, and there are insurance requirements.
My only concern is if we approve it, are we subject to a lawsuit? That's all.
Well, a great advice and a solution by Councilor Thompson, that is part of the motion will have subject to hold and save harmless. Is that what it's called, Councilor?
Hold harmless agreement.
Hold harmless agreement to be in place and enforced. Okay, everyone understand? Yes, all in favor? Okay, it's unanimous. Thank you, Mr. Clerk. Are there any additional items for council?
No, Your Worship.
Okay. Okay. First, we need ratification of in-camera. Okay, there are no ratifications. Motion to move the consent agenda. Councilor Iannone, seconded by Councilor Morocco. I'm sorry. Yes, Councilor Mays.
The one on the buses.
Okay, which item is that? That okay, yep, here we go. Okay, Councillor Pietrangelo?
I'm W2012-64.
Okay, any other to be pulled? Yeah, Councillor Thompson?
Yes, follow them.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any other? Councillor Gates?
Sorry,
I think Councillor Thompson. Okay, there are no other. We'll call the vote on the remainder of the... Okay, we've already got a motion. All those in favor? Okay, it's unanimous. We'll start with MW 2012-13, Falls Avenue, formerly Robert Street, Gateway Landscape Boulevard, and Media Maintenance. Councillor Thompson.
Yeah, just a question. I see that regional road, we are participating in what was originally an agreement with the Parks Commission, the region, and the city. Is our involvement strictly the $30,000 and the region $15,000, and how did we arrive at that?
Okay, Mr. Holman?
Mr. Mayor, the city's responsibility under the operating agreement will be for the flower beds and the irrigation system, and then the region will look after the costs associated with cutting the grass on the boulevards and the media.
And the Parks Commission is not involved at all?
Parks Commission has pulled out of their previous obligations in this area.
Thank you. Okay. Any other comments on this? Yes, Councilor Gates?
Yeah, again, just going to the package here. I just want to make sure that I'm right. It says that it's a regional road, correct?
Yes.
I'm right there. And the cost to the city to take care of it is $30,000. I guess my question is, if it's a regional road, why isn't the region taking care of it? Rather than spending taxpayers' money for a regional road.
Mr. Shulman?
Mr. Mayor, it's the region is agreeing to provide the same service they provide on any other regional road, which is the care and maintenance of the boulevard within the road line. This is something that's been kind of handed to us by default. We could choose not to deal with the flower beds and let them go, and leave the responsibility up to the region, and likely the beds will be removed and we'll have pretty much what you have as you enter any other municipality. Our official plan talks about making this an important entranceway, not just for our own residents, but for tourism, people moving in and out of the country. So we thought it would be appropriate to at least maintain this on a short-term basis. We can have a look at partnerships again as other events come up, but generally speaking, it's consistent with our official plan. It's not our road. We didn't make any initial capital investments. The Parks Commission did that, the tune of, I don't know what the number is, $1.5 million. But I think it's consistent with what we're trying to achieve here at a very important gateway to our community.
Okay, thank you for that. Okay, Councillor Thompson.
Well, that's certainly the reason I highlighted it's the same as the regional road. But just go back, I don't know, 15 or 20 years where this was all derelict housing that the Department of Highways bought up half of it and then left it. It was a disaster. The entrance to the Niagara Parks Commission and the City of Niagara Falls. A lot of effort put in getting the Parks Commission, the region, and the city tear down all the houses. There's only four of them, I think, that resisted. There was no forced sale, and we created a beautiful entrance. This was our idea initially. We got the other parties involved. Unfortunately, the former chairman, former general manager of the Parks Commission, made the decision to get out of everything in Niagara Falls, and that's precipitated this situation. We have a choice. We either want a beautiful entrance to the park system and the City of Niagara Falls and the falls itself, or we could let it go to let the region cut the grass and let everything go to waste. Certainly not a wise thing to do. So not happy with the expenditure, but it's certainly worthwhile with something that we've created here.
Councillor?
Yeah, just a question to I guess go through the Mayor Diodati. Have we done this with any other regional road? Do we do it anywhere else in the city on a regional road where we'd be spending money taking care of a regional road other than the gateway? And I get Councillor Thompson's you know, I get a little bit of the history on why it was done and how it was done and the reasons why, but do we do this with any other regional road?
Oh, wait, the historian has one.
Stanley Avenue coming in, the private sector on the regional road, the Falls View area, created all those islands and beautification because the other part was upgraded, so they thought it was appropriate. But mostly private sector funding was involved in Stanley Avenue from McLeod up to the Falls View area.
Oh, yeah. Yep. Okay, so I need a motion to receive the report, MW 2012-13, moved by Councillor Morocco, second by Councillor Pietrangelo. All those in favor? Okay, thank you. Next up, MW 2012-64, Municipal Infrastructure Investment Initiative Capital Program. Councillor Pietrangelo.
Thanks, Your Worship. Just had a question in regards to the projects that were considered. They're on page 4, actually. It's on the back of the report. Has Atlantis Avenue, Taylor Road, Robinson Street. I understand just by looking at the numbers that you're looking at getting the largest grant out of all three of those. I'm just wondering if those are the only three projects that were considered or if there were others actually that were considered.
Mr. Olin?
We did consider two other projects. One was the Mewburn Road Bridge, which did not qualify because we don't own it. And the other area that we wanted to move ahead in our capital forecast was to rehabilitate 5 rural structures, Miller Road, Willoughby Drive, couple others I can't think of off the top of my head. My conversation with the people running the program was that you couldn't bundle the projects. They would have to be dealt with on an individual basis. There are other projects that need to be dealt with through our capital budget process, but these were the ones that seemed to fit the criteria the best. Councillor?
Yeah, thanks, Your Worship. And I mean, I'm not really privy to the criteria too much. I'm just wondering, through you to Mr. Holman, maybe, did Destin Slater Forsyth ever get done with the sewer separation and road rehabilitation there?
No. The design is underway now, but the reconstruction, the dollars for construction have not been allocated yet. It'll be something for consideration this year.
And I guess the reason that I asked is because I remember that one carrying a price tag of, I think it was $3.4 million. So I'm just wondering, out of that $3.4, and that was a few years back when we were looking at the infrastructure stimulus on the ISF, that was the price tag back then. Just looking at the total project cost, it's higher than a couple of the other ones here. So I'm wondering what the qualification under the MIII grant would be. I guess offhand you wouldn't know what those numbers would be.
So I don't have them here, Mr. Mayor, but I can share them with the council if they need.
I guess, Your Worship, I'm just hoping that, again, same as staff, trying to get the biggest bang from the MIII grant. I know that was a high-priced project that was on our books a few years ago. That's all.
Okay, Councillor Thompson and Wayne.
Yeah. Do I read this report properly when you're suggesting Atlantis Avenue? Are you suggesting because it is not the most expensive project that it will be done under the capital budget this year? I had several calls. Apparently there's been a substantial amount of residential development there, and people have been told for several years that Atlantis is going to be done. Does that mean that we're not getting rid of Atlantis? We're saying Atlantis will be done during, I guess we approve it during the capital budget. Is that right?
That's correct. The design funding for the design portion was approved in the 2012 budget, and that's well underway, and we should be in a position to have a public meeting early in the new year, and it definitely will be on the list that we'll be considering in February.
Good. Thank you.
Okay, Councillor Wayne.
Yes, I was going to ask for this report to be lifted as well. I had similar concerns. I had calls about Atlantis and particularly about Robinson. There's a Robinson Street resident whose co-workers ask her, don't you pay your taxes? Why is your road in such rough shape? A lot of people use Robinson to access their jobs in the tourist areas. The bus uses it. I've had complaints from bus riders. The main ferry BIA, I know, has discussed its condition. Tourists use it sometimes to get to the main and ferry area, and that one in particular I noted is in the worst shape. All the roads are rated as poor, the water main is very poor, the sanitary sewer is poor. So of the three projects here, it's really the one that has the most critical need in terms of infrastructure condition. And it also mentioned in the report that there being an available storm sewer outlet at Robinson Stanley, this would provide an outlet for areas upstream, so along Main Street and other parts of the Robinson. So to me, this just seemed to be, Robinson seemed to be the very best candidate of the three. I haven't had any calls from the public about the condition of Kalar, which is the one being put forward, but I have heard about both Atlantis and Robinson. So I'm wondering, like, with only a $20,000 difference in what we'd get in terms of grants for Kalar and Robinson, why would we not put Robinson forward? Because to me, that's the one that is really crying for attention more than any of the others.
We can get an answer, Mr. Holman. Any comments on that?
I would be happy to do all three of the projects if you gave the money. I think what we're looking for here is which one of these projects would we not be able to do if we didn't get $2 million from another source? And maybe that's the best way to try and describe the final decision criteria. Councillor Wing has made some really good points about the advantages of, you know, the sewer separation that we could do in there and how it would help us with our sewage flows and as well as improve the traffic to and from the main ferry area. But as I say, any one of them would fit the bill. I think the final criteria was which project would we not be able to do if we didn't get the outside money.
So then, with that being the criteria, are we saying that we will be able to do Robinson Street for sure this year, no matter what?
Mr. Holman, I'd like to ask the same question. I remember this conversation in February when we're
doing our budget.
But I know that you have a number of other important issues we have to deal with as a municipality, and this project's not going to go away. So if we don't do it this year, we'll do it next year. If there is money available, even just to advance the engineering portion of it, or the underground portion of it, we'll look at that as we move to our capital budget discussion. But it's here because it's a priority.
So what he's saying is it's up to us when we come to budget time if we're going to...
Yeah, I think I'm looking for a guarantee that Robinson will get done in 2013. I'd like Levantis to be done in 2013 as well. I think those are both really critical. I'm not going to support this simply because I think Robinson and Levantis should go before Kayla.
Okay, Councillor Pierangelo?
Your Worship, just to speak to that point, and I don't know, maybe Mr. Holman can verify whether or not my thinking is correct, but I would think that any project that we put forward probably wouldn't get done in 2013 because we'd be waiting to hear about the funding, and by the time the funding was approved and then the RFPs went out, it wouldn't get done in 2013 anyway. So if you want to guarantee that a project is done in 2013, then make sure that it's in the capital budget as opposed to applying for grant money. That's what I would think. I don't know.
Is that accurate, Mr. Holmes?
Well, I can't say for sure, but the process is two steps. By the 9th of January, we have to submit our expression of interest. We'll be informed 2 weeks after that, and then we have 45 days to submit the formal application. We have until the end of 2014 to complete the project, because it's really two budget cycles to fund and complete the work. And I know that the Kayla Road job, we're expecting that we can complete the work in about 7 to 8 months, depending on when we get started. So it can be done, but those first couple of months at the beginning of the season are critical, and if we are waiting to hear about funding, then sometimes that puts us behind.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, Councillor Gates. Just quick, I can appreciate what Jeff is saying, but just on Atlantis, I think the key word in the write-up that I see is that this section of roadway was listed as number 8 on the Niagara Worst Road list in 2012. So I think it becomes a need. I think that's, you know, something that maybe the councillors, or my fellow councillors, as we're trying to figure out what to do with money over the next few months. But I think that one line says it all about that area, and I just thought I'd repeat it. Thanks.
Yeah, I'm sure, Mr. Holman, I'm sure a lot of support for that area. Yes, Councillor Pierangelo.
Yeah, Your Worship, just on that point, I mean, through you to Mr. Holman, is Atlantis Avenue in the 2013 capital budget presently? And that's what I thought. So we really shouldn't be arguing about whether or not Atlantis Avenue is going to get done. It should get done, so long as we approve the capital budget. Am I correct in that?
Well, the design portion in 2012, and we'll have that ready to go. It's just a matter of whether or not we can allocate construction dollars for that in 2013, and that's your call.
Okay,
so we're good with that? Okay, I need a motion to receive the report moved by Councillor Iannone, second by Councillor Morocco. All those in favor? Opposed? Okay, Councillor Wing opposed?
Okay.
You're opposed to?
No.
Okay. And then last up, TS 2012-40 RFP for supply of 40-foot conventional buses. Councillor Mays.
Yeah, Your Worship, just want to ask Mr. Dren a few questions regarding these buses. Are these replacement buses? Are we getting rid of something? Is something old that you're replacing?
The one for 2012 is a replacement bus.
Pardon me?
The one for 2012 is a replacement bus. In other words, we've already retired one bus and we're down one bus.
How old are the buses you're retiring?
Well, for 2012 is a replacement bus. It's gone. Mm-hmm. So that one, I believe, I don't know the exact age, but it would be around the 15 to 18 year mark.
Mm-hmm.
So it's gone.
Yeah. The other thing is, too, of the $856,000, how much of that do we get back in gas tax?
That's 100% funded.
So is there like three buses? Why do we get a dozen of them? I think we've been through this. Now, I'm just wondering, though, too, with that kind of money, do we have an option to spend the money? Do we have to buy buses, or can it be spent in another area?
This money here is dedicated to transit, mm-hmm. and of the money we get for gas tax, we get approximately $1.1 million a year. 532 already goes to operating, mm-hmm. so all there is left is approximately about another 500 to 600,000 per year right now. This will also, by purchasing these buses, it will allow us to do 100% accessibility on our conventional route. So when we receive these buses, we'll be able to advertise and promote 100% accessible buses on our conventional system.
Okay, one last question too. I noticed the region buses, and we've got the Brock Run. They seem to be overlapping. Is that being worked on? Can we pull back on some of that service, or can we save some dollars?
Yeah, the plan is as I indicated when I did my budget presentation, we're going to be reviewing that this year. You just can't turn the switch and say now we're not going to do it anymore, because the region doesn't have the buses to take on the amount of passengers from the university and the college. So it's something that would happen over time. These buses that would remain, the high floors, are good for another 4 years. That's why we don't want to get rid of them. And they will be dedicated to the college and the university until we can divest ourselves, as long as the region can handle it.
Yeah, because I see a lot of the same route in that. The other thing is too, on the WEGO, are we on a winter system now with that? Because I noticed a lot of the buses are going still, and I know that it was very successful during the summer months. Is it being scaled down now as winter is here, or is it?
Yes, it has been scaled back, and as well, council has given us directive at the last meeting to meet with the Lundy's Lane Group and also look at other opportunities to reduce service.
Great, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Okay, move the purchase of the buses. Councillor Iannone, seconded by Councillor Wing. Yes, Councillor Thompson?
You said Lundy's Lane BIA. I think the motion was Lundy's Lane and the other BIA, so we go.
Yes? That's the motion? Okay, good.
No, that was the motion last
meeting. Last time, yeah, that's right. Okay, so we have a motion to purchase two buses from Nova Bus. All those in favor? Okay, it's unanimous. Thank you. All right, moving on to resolutions. We have a resolution. Yes, Mr. Clerk.
Yeah, this is a resolution related to the report, Jeff's report on the MIII program. We're required to pass that resolution, so it's just committing that project, the Kaler Road project, but more specifically that the expression of interest that we're submitting is factually accurate, and that we are committed to undertaking a comprehensive asset management plan by December 31st of 2013.
Okay, the resolution is moved by Councillor Pietrangelo and seconded by Councillor Morocco. All those in favor? Okay, thank you. Was there anyone opposed? Councillor Wing? Yes, okay, Councillor Wing opposed. Bylaws. Mr. Clerk, are there any additional bylaws?
There's one additional bylaw. You have a couple of bylaws related to the iconic towers. The additional bylaw is related to the Section 37 agreement, so that bylaw will be 2012-142, and the confirmatory bylaw will be 143.
Okay. Motion by Councillor Pietrangelo, second by Councillor Thompson, to have the bylaws read for the first time. All those in favor? Okay.
Bylaws 2012-132 to 2012-143, read a first time.
Second and third motion by Councilor Pietrangelo, second by Councilor Thompson. All those in favor?
Bylaws 2012-132 to 2012-143, read a second and third time and passed.
Okay, new business? Councilor Thompson, Councilor Morocco?
Yes, I'll make this very brief. I have been waiting for a report to come to council for a couple of months now. Obviously, Mr. Harrison has been negligent in getting that report to us. But I have Frank Greco, who has been vitally interested in the resolution with respect to assessment. Not that that's going to solve his problems, but it's another step that we can take to try to influence the thinking with respect to residential properties that are torn down that become tourist commercial automatically. I think Mr. Greco has been frustrated by the fact that I've told him each meeting is coming at the next meeting. I want to shift all the responsibility to Mr. Harrison, who hasn't fulfilled his obligation, and hopefully this can be at the first meeting in the new year, so we can try to deal with this problem, which is not only Mr. Greco's concern, but numerous other areas and districts with the same situation. So, sorry, Frank.
Would you make a motion that we have Mr. Harrison come in over the holidays, Christmas holidays? Christmas Eve, yes? We'll finish that up. All right. So appreciate that, yes, Mr. Frieda?
Yeah, the only reason why the report's been delayed more recently is due to the fact there's no provincial government, and what we would have to do is propose changes to the Assessment Act. So, you know.
Well, there's no reason to hold up the process. We can debate it and discuss it. January 27th is going to be all kinds of announcements regarding the new premier and people suggesting that they're going to run for public office at that particular time. So let's send it to Impact and also to the government.
Absolutely.
Okay. And we have to debate it here and approve it anyway.
Okay. Thank you.
So we're already
pulling your stocking. All right, Councilor Morocco.
Yes, I'll make this really quick. As the past chair of the Greater Niagara General Hospital Foundation and co-chair of It's Our Time campaign, I had the opportunity, along with many other volunteers today, to go and do a tour of the 1 million square feet of hospital in St. Catharines. And I have to say, it was just amazing for the technology that we have in the Niagara region, and this is a new facility. I only really hope that this is a duplicate of what we'll get in Niagara South in the future. Mm-hmm. So we'll keep our fingers crossed on that. And also, I see that we did receive an email today for January 9th from 10 to 4 to do a tour of that site as well. So I hope that many of the staff and counselors get an opportunity to tour the new site.
Definitely. Any other new business? Mm-hmm. Motion for adjournment, Councilor Iannone, second by Councilor Maves. All those in favor? All right, Merry Christmas, everyone. Have a great Christmas season.
Kitty costume, Santa Claus is coming to town. On a kids and girls and boys and we'll have a jubilee. They're gonna build a twirling town all around my Christmas tree. You better watch out, you better not cry, better not pout, I'm telling you right. Santa Claus is coming, Santa Claus is coming, Santa Claus is coming to town. Snow, the wind is blowing.
weather, the storm. What do I care how much it may dawn? I've got my love to keep me warm. Oh, I can't remember a word, dear December. Just watch those icicles fall.